know people complain and I have things on the table.
Complain no matter what.
No, the marshal with the donkey and the father and the boy. Why the boy's on a donkey and you're walking? Why the boy's walking and you're sitting? Why you're picking up the donkey? Okay, let's go. Good evening. Hanukkah is coming, Baruch Hashem, Thursday evening, first candle. This shiur today will be the Refuat Aliza Malka Batlea and Avdi Leilui Nishmat Bluma. בת שבע, בת שמואל, מנשה בן נקדם, זאב בן סוריה. Also for the successful engagement and marriage of אליהו קלמן בן אברהם and תהילה ברכה בת ציפור החנה. Yesterday we had a fire lecture in Queens. It won't go on. It will not go on the website. So you can only watch it now on Google, YouTube Live. It's still there, on my YouTube page, Rabbi Yosef Mizrachi. I want everyone to subscribe to my YouTube page because from now on we're gonna do YouTube Live instead of Facebook Live. What are we doing now? We're doing YouTube or Facebook?
Both.
Okay, so Tuesday we'll do both. But on Monday we will only do YouTube Live. I know a lot of people complain, they waited for the Facebook. The reason we don't want to do Facebook is because they limit 90% of the exposure anyway, these lefty traders. They don't want Torah, they don't want anything that they hate. But to begin with, they limit the exposure. It doesn't go to all the people in my page. If it would go to all the people in my page, we would have over 100,000 views if they would share. Right? With them sharing, we got over 100,000 people, but obviously 90% of the exposure they cut. So better for now, we'll still do it with YouTube while we can. Baruch Hashem, yesterday I spoke about some things that we have to be careful of. Since I started to talk about it last Monday, it's already 8 days, there was not one day without robberies. Non-stop robberies, and don't expect the police to come. They just don't come. They don't come. You're gonna sit there, wait 6-7 hours, they don't show up. The reason they don't show up, two reasons. One, they have it every 20 minutes in New York now. They don't care. Maybe if it's armed robbery, they will show up. But if it's not with weapon, they won't show up. Second is they are burned out. The idiot mayor of New York burned the police out. Did not appreciate them, cut their budget, made them the bad people. They have no motivation. Why should they waste their time? So they do everything they can not to do anything. Right? I know it for a fact because some of them take haircuts by one of my students, Bukhari and Barber, and they told him, we get calls, we don't go. We just don't go. We ignore it. So here you go. We have a new world now. 50% at least of the police is off. If you count on the police, you'll be very disappointed. So that's one thing. You gotta be very careful from these robberies. You should listen to last night's lecture. I gave instructions what should be done. One more thing. A lot of people now were heading to Dubai with the lousy, dirty magazines that call themselves religious, that brainwash all the people with all the advertisement. When people read it, the entire Shabbat, destroy the holiness of Shabbat with these tame magazines, wicked, and they brainwash the people and impurify their neshama and their brain. And now all of a sudden, every religious Jew is heading to Dubai. It's just a matter of time until the Iranians will start attacking Jews in Dubai in massive attacks. Just a matter of days. They're already planning attacks on Jewish groups, mainly Israeli that speaks Hebrew. The Iranians are furious that we killed some of their key people. They're preparing retaliation. Don't don't go to Dubai. Don't make Shabbatons there. Don't go on trips there. There's nothing to see there besides some nice buildings. It's not going to add anything to your Olam Haba, that's for sure. Don't go. You understand? Not everything people do, you have to follow. You're not a sheep. And sheep, everybody follow the shepherd. Or the doors push everyone to one side. In the ocean, same thing. The waves take the fish. When they're all dead, the waves bring all the fish to the shore. You have to be alive. Someone that is alive is going to decide where to go, where and when. Not because everyone is doing it, that means you have to do it. Israel is very excited. They made some peace agreements with Bahrain, the Emirates, Dubai. But surprisingly, not with Saudi. Saudi Arabia did not sign an agreement with Israel yet. How can it be? Nothing happens over there without them.
The kingdom is left.
Oh, so they have over there, they have an old king, old-fashioned king. And they have his son, this Ben Salman. The son wants to make peace. The father is old-fashioned. He doesn't want to make peace with Israel. At least they allow us to fly over Saudi now. Saves us some time and money. But there is different reasons why they don't want to make peace with us. Why?
Yeah.
Why? The reason is because they are shaking from Iran. Iran is a very dangerous country. They have thousands of terrorists, experts in bombing, in shooting, all over the Middle East, in every country. Even in Israel, they have spies. Could be some Iranian Jews, that they turned them into spies by giving them a lot of money. And they're not idiots. These Iranians, they're smart. You see, they have advanced high tech. They have the best hackers in the world after Israel. They hacked the Israeli company. Now there's a big insurance company in Israel. They took them total hostage. Hundreds of thousands of Israeli driver's license, social security, name, private information, they hold everything. And they threaten them that if they don't pay the millions of dollars, they're going to publish all of it to all over the world. People will steal all your identities. The Iranians are very dangerous. They don't have to necessarily get a nuclear bomb. They have enough sechel brain to cause us huge damage. Of course, it's all depends if Hashem will agree or not. In the end, nothing happens without Hashem. But they're very dangerous. A few months ago, they bombed some oil place of Saudi Arabia, cost them over $1 billion damage. The Saudis are shaking from them. No wonder all the Arab countries condemned the execution of the Iranian scientists. All of a sudden, all the Arab countries condemned it. Why do you condemn it? That's the best thing that can have happened to you in the last 100 years. He is going to be in charge of you going to hell, all of you. So finally he's dead. Of course they're happy. Indoor, they drink l'chaim. But for the media, they wanna ease the anger of these Persians. Why? Because they wanna avoid massive attacks in their place. It's all politics. There's nothing to be excited from what you read on the news, because in the end it's all politics. The question is, why the Europeans are so stupid? We already know Sleepy Joe, Obama, the Iran agreement, naive, foolish, stupid, we know it. Now why the Europeans are so dumb? Why the Europeans are not worried about the fact that Iran one day will have a nuclear bomb? That's very bad for the Europeans. It's bad for France, it's bad for England, it's bad for a lot of countries. Why not? Why they are so easy and soft with it? Why they would want to sign a stupid agreement that means nothing and let them get a bomb? I'll tell you a secret. I'll tell you a big secret now that you probably never thought about. The Europeans invested, each country, tens of millions of dollars in Iran. In high tech, in business, in oil, in many big companies, just like they did in Iraq. When the Americans went to Iraq and brought down Saddam Hussein, the Europeans lost hundreds of billions of dollars by the Iraqi government, the new government told the Europeans, go to Saddam to pay you the debt. We don't have nothing to do with you. All their investments went down the drain. Same thing is going to happen now with Iran. That's why they're so anti-Trump. Trump caused them so much damage by putting sanctions against Iran. Why they always try to help Iran? They're not trying to help Iran. They're not that stupid to help their own enemies. They just want to save their money. They are investors a lot of money. That's why don't expect any logic from the Europeans. They let Iran have a bomb, they don't care. They just want to make money. So for them, it's good to cancel the sanction against Iran. Sleepy Joe receive a lot of money from those countries. Who knows how much bribe they give them. So okay, fine, we understand what's going on here. There's a lot of corruption. So you see, Rabotai, in the end, everything that happens, it's like Kadosh Baruch Hu is doing it to us. We can say thank you to Hashem that the punishment is not the worst it could have been. Imagine if Bernie Sanders would be. Just imagine life under this Bernie, the communist. So we are paying the price for the way we behave. And it's only going to get worse. If we're not going to change, Hashem is going to continue to bring more problems. We are now before Hanukkah. In Hanukkah, we say Hallel for 8 days. Very interesting. It's rabbinical holiday. Hallel, full Hallel with bracha. Very interesting. And the big thing in Hanukkah to publish the miracle that Hashem made for us. Hanukkah is the only holiday that the miracle happened in the Holy Land. All other holidays, the miracles happen out of Israel. Out of Israel. That's the only holiday that we're actually celebrating a miracle that Hashem made inside the Holy Land. When was it? 3,572 years to the creation of the world. We are now 5,781, right? So that was about 2,200 years ago. 2,200 years ago. That's the story of Hanukkah. The Hashmonaim family of Kohanim, Matityahu and his 5 sons, fought the Greeks. Who was the king of the Greeks? Antiochus the Fourth. Antiochus. By the Goyim, they always have names for the kings, but it's the same name. Paro, Paro, Paro. Everyone is Paro. Right? Avimelech, 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 Avimelech. It's not one Avimelech. The first, the second, the third. Also by the Greeks. By the Greeks, Antiochus the first, the second, the third, the fourth. That's Antiochus the Fourth. That's the evil one. For 20 years, there was a war between the Maccabim to the Greeks. When we read it, we think it was a matter of 2-3 months. 20 years war, what do you think? It wasn't 1 day or 2 days. Even when Hashem made such a big miracle, he still dragged it for 20 years. Why? Why not doing it in 6 days, like the 6 day war? Why do you have to drag it 20 years? We'll see why. Antiochus made spiritual decrees against the Jews. Remember, the Greeks is different than the other empires. The other empires wanted to kill us or control us physically and collect money from us. It was just like a regular war. Nothing to do with spirituality. They know that the most painful thing to the Jews is to destroy Beit HaMikdash. That's why the Babylonians and the Romans, that's what they came to do. By doing that, you destroy us. That's our life. Destroyed our temple. That's what they did. So they came to torture us. The Greeks, it was a whole different story. The Greeks were what we call today Democrats. Socialist, communist, all these bad names. Bad names. The truth is, I don't know why, but we call the Democrats, we call them socialists. But that's a mistake, big mistake. Why? Who were socialists?
The Nazis.
The Nazis. The Nazis, they were very patriotic to their country, and they were called National Socialist Party. That's why they've made a short of it, Nazi. National Socialist. This democratic communist is nothing but patriots. They are the biggest traitors against their own country. And when you say socialist, yes, in some way they are, but they are very different than the Nazis. Nothing to compare between them and them. So they're much more communist than national socialist. But it's very tricky words. One thing for sure, they are very bad and evil, no matter how you want to call them. And they are very anti-spirituality. They are the biggest enemy of religion. As you can see, they are pro-gays and pro-abortion and pro-taking the money from the rich and giving it to the poor who does nothing. They don't care. They have such horrible values that almost everything they ever said and did is against God. Almost everything. Very, very rarely that you're going to find that they do something positive. Almost impossible. Whatever they do, it's always against Hashem. That's why we, the religious people, whether you are Jewish or non-Jewish, any religious person who cares about God has to despise them very much. Why? Because God cannot stand that you kiss up to wicked people. Remember, you're not allowed to give one compliment to a wicked person. Even when he does something positive, it's against the Jewish law. You can read in Orchot Tzadikim, chapter that called Chanufa, kissing up to the wicked people. Over there, it's written that there are four groups who can never accept the presence of Hashem. Never. They can never be in the same place with God, meaning they are on a ban. Hashem put a ban on this kind of people. Four different groups, and one of them is people that kiss up to wicked people. Why would a righteous person want to kiss up to a wicked person? The answer is for personal gain. Money, promotion, to avoid conflict, to avoid attack, to avoid in social media that they're going to bash your name. There's all kinds of reasons for it. Or that maybe you will give money. So there are many different reasons. All of those reasons are not kosher. All of them. You're not supposed to be nice to wicked people because you want them to donate money. You have to tell them the truth, and if they don't want to donate, it's their problem, not yours. Hashem's going to take care of you. You don't depend on these wicked people to feed you. I once told you a story. Once it was a yeshiva, a big yeshiva for hundreds of kids, very strict, good yeshiva, Ben David it's called. This yeshiva started small and over the years became very big. And when Rav Yaakov Kaminetsky Zatzal, Alav HaShalom, was still alive, he lived, I think, 95 years. And he was very, very honest. Besides being a legendary, big Talmid Chacham and very holy person with great midot, his chotam, his main stamp was straight like a ruler. Not one tiny turn, left or right, like this. That's it. You'll never find him say something that is even a little bit like a lie. Never. Not all his life. He never said one thing that's not the truth. Do you remember once I told you the story about the fish, that he once told a woman that he doesn't like fish because her fish was horrible, and from that day, he did not eat fish for 80 years. Not to make it a lie, retroactive. This is who we're talking here about. This is people that are big legends. They deserve all the admiration in the world. His son is also one of Gdol Israel, of Philadelphia, of Shmuel Kaminetsky, Baruch Hashem, father and son. So they came to him as a very big rabbi. They told him that they have to expand the place, they need to buy a place or to build. And there's one Jew that is married to a non-Jewish woman. used to be religious, went off the derech, married a goya, but he probably feel guilty about his life, so he wants to give a big donation to help the yeshiva. But he has one condition. Usually when the rich people give money for a building, there's a reason why they look to give money for a building. There's a reason. Why? They want their name on a building. There's a lot of fancy buildings around. Pay attention. Almost all of them have names. Someone is willing to pay $1 or $2 or $5 or $10 million that his name will remain 50 years on a building. And everyone who drives by says, wow. Look what a building he built, or buildings. Okay, that's their choice. They want to lose the reward in the eternal world to get some honor in this temporary world. Be my guest, if that's what you want, fine. But they came to have Kamenetsky and they say, he's willing to give us all the money in one shot, now we don't have to make a campaign and run to so many people and collect dollar by dollar, but he wants his name on a building. So he told them, absolutely, it's not possible. Speak Chilul Hashem. Imagine everyone who comes and sees his name. They said, well, this yeshiva couldn't find the money from a kosher source. Just from this guy, not even Shomer Shabbos. They depend on him to sponsor the building. It's big Chilul Hashem. So they went back to this person and they said, thank you very much for your good intention. But obviously it's a little bit delicate, the situation, because of your lifestyle and the parents in our school, and the Monsi is a place of religious people. It won't look so good. You know, he knows Torah. He grew up religious. It's big Chilul Hashem. We won't be able to take your money and put your name on a building. So he shows some humility, this guy. He says, you have a good point. I'm waiving my request. You don't have to put my name on a building. I will still give you the full amount. Big tzaddikim don't move an inch without go back to the rabbi and ask. They don't jump. Oh, thank you. Shkoyach, shkoyach. Write the check. No. We have to ask. They ran quickly to Rabbi Yaakov Kamenetsky. Rabbi, that's the new deal. The offering. He said to them, now I cannot tell you that it's not allowed. Before it was not allowed, it's Chilul Hashem. Now, if the name is not on the building, I cannot tell you that it's not allowed. But if it was up to me, I would rather take the money to build the yeshiva from different source. He hinted to them. Baruch Hashem, the people there cared about the truth more than the money. And they said, Rabbi, that's what we're going to do. And he told him, thank you very much for your offer, but we will decline it. And quickly after, by a miracle after miracle, they were able to collect all the money relatively very fast and expand the place, and today is a massive empire. Why? It was blessing. Blessing in a place. Who knows how it would end if they would take a few million dollars from that person, where they would be today. Only Hashem knows. But that's what life is all about. You have a moment of a test, you fail it, and 20 years later you realize you failed, and you see the consequences. Not always you see. In the beginning it looks very good. Wow, it's great we took. Look what we have. Yamin Yagidu. Sometimes you need patience to see the end of Hashem. Not sometimes, almost always. So now, the Greeks, unlike the other empires, their agenda is to destroy spirituality. They very much into body, weights, boxing, wrestling, marathons, running, competitions, stadiums. They invented sport. The Greeks, Sparta, they invented the sport. Olympics is from Olympus, there's a city in Greece. It's a big, on a big mountain, and that's where the game started. Everything you see today, everyone's crazy, addicted to sport everywhere you go. They are the ones who planted that poisonous seed in that generation 2,200 years ago that penetrated almost to the heart of every human being today. All over the world, everywhere you go. People without it cannot live. They have to see what they do now, not to stop the games, Corona time. Crazy, they play in the empty stadium, Everyone with a stupid feast like this, like it's gonna make a difference if they shake hands or they go like this. Honestly, just not to stop the games. That's the Greeks. And of course, as long as the Jews are around and they teach their Jewish philosophy, we the Greeks will always look fake. Because remember, the whole world knows that these Jews, they didn't invent their philosophy like us. It's not human philosophy. We, the Greeks and the rest of the world, witnessed the fact that God gave the Jews his book in a public event, cannot deny it, 1100 years ago. Remember, in their time, it was only 1100 years ago, but it's enough time. Over 1,000 years, Judaism is all over the world, and that's the main religion in the world. There's no Christianity yet. There's no Islam. There's no Islam. No Christianity. That's almost 4 billion people today, Muslims and Christians. They didn't have that. The Greeks did not have a religion. They had Greek mythology. That's it. They believe in different gods, the god of the ocean, the god of this, the god of that. But the Greeks, they are very hungry for wisdom. Unlike other nations, the word philosophy, it's a Greek word. What is it? Hunger for knowledge. Craving knowledge. That's what it means, philosophy, in Greek. Everybody is searching for knowledge, argument, philosophy, arguing about this, about free will. The person has free will or not? What's the Greek opinion about free will? They ask a question. If God knows the future, how is it possible that we are choosing? You already know if we be righteous or wicked, if we be rich or poor, everything you know already. It's not in our hand. If you already knew the day I was born, how I'm gonna die, that means all my life I'm a robot. One thing we don't understand, how can you come with such a crooked conclusion? If you come with such a conclusion, then what happened? How do you have court? How do you have judges? How do you have police? And how do you have jails? And how do you do executions? How you torture prisoners? All of that is against your belief. If you believe the person is a robot and he doesn't choose what to do, it's not fair to give him double punishment. One time it was decreed on him to kill someone. And now you're going and kill him for that? Twice either you punish him? One time he was forced to kill someone and now you're killing him for that? How are you judging someone that you yourself say did not have a free will? So the Greeks, they say, in that case, the conclusion is that a person has a free will. So what are we gonna do with the claim that God doesn't know the future or he knows the future? Conclusion, God does not know the future. Because it cannot be that he knows the future and we choose. It's a contradiction. So the Greeks came to a conclusion that God doesn't know the future. But in the Torah, we have proofs that God knows the future. For instance, when Moshe and Aaron went to Pharaoh in Parashat Bo, Hashem said to him, up to now, Pharaoh talked to you and all that, and he had a chance to send you. From now on, Pharaoh will not listen to you. He cannot send the Jewish nation anymore. Imagine if Pharaoh would surprise. Pharaoh would say, you know what? Okay, I'm surrendering. After 6 plagues, go! Go! What would happen with Hashem's promise? It would be a proof that he doesn't know the future. Here you go. But that's exactly what happened. Also, when King David asked Hashem, while he was running away from Shaul HaMelech to try to kill him, he wanted to go to a city called Keilah. Not Kehilah. Keilah means community. With hey. Keilah with Ayin. So he asked Hashem, will the people of Keilah will betray me and turn me to the hand of Shaul or not? And Hashem said, they will. And therefore he knew what to do. So you see, there are many sources in the Torah and the Tanakh that Hashem knew the future. The best proof is the prophets. The prophets gave prophecies, and you saw in history how they happened. But the Torah is full of prophecies, which all of them happen. besides the ones that their time did not arrive yet. But those who the time arrived for them, they happen. Like, for instance, the Torah say, I will take you to Israel, I will throw the seven nations out of there. I will give you the land, I will let you build a house for me in a place I will choose. If you're going to follow my rules, I will live among you, I will be your father, you will be my children. All of these beautiful blessings and promises. But if you want, I will send a nation from far away that their sign is an eagle, and they'll be very cruel, that you would not recognize their language, meaning it's not one of your neighbors. And the people who were around Israel, their sign was not eagle. Who is he talking about? The Romans from Italy. So the Roman Empire, their sign is eagle, the Nazis were eagle, the Russians are eagle, the Americans are eagle, all the empires are eagle. It's unbelievable. Why? Because they're all children of Esav. It's all the same family. There's one time is the lady dressed with a blue dress, and tomorrow with a black one, and the next day with a red one. But it's the same lady. One time they come like Germans, the next time they come as Russians, and now they come as Americans, same thing. Look at all the flags. The Nazis and their symbol was an eagle. So the Romans, the same thing. Romans are eagle. They will come from far away. They will not have mercy on women and children and old people. They will destroy the temple. They will throw you out of Israel. They will take you to Egypt with boats. And they will sell you over there for slavery, and no one would be interested to buy you, to the point that the price of one slave will be cheaper than the price of a meal of a horse. In our days, less than $5. That was the price of a Jewish slave. And all these prophecies was given 1300 years before it actually happened in detail. 1300 years before the Torah was given. The Romans did it 2000 years ago. But this was written in the Torah 1300 years earlier. And not only that, who would bother to take Jewish prisoners from Israel to Egypt with boats? Today you have huge boats with engines and gas and solar, whatever. So big deal, you put 5,000 people and you take them to Egypt with a boat. But back then they had boats that you had to manually move and with the wind. Why would you bring so many boats to take thousands of prisoners to Egypt when you can make them walk? 3 days they walk and they are in Egypt. Why do you need to bother? But that was the Torah, that's what the Torah promised. The Torah promised that that's what's going to happen. That's exactly what happened. So you see, from the Torah, there are prophecies that each one of them, one by one in details, actually happened. So the Greeks came to the wrong conclusion, that it cannot be that God knows the future, but they were wrong. What's with the Arabs? The Arabs also asked that question. Every normal human being asked this question. If God knows the future, what am I doing here? Am I responsible for my fortune or not? Or maybe it was determined already before I came to the world and I'm just a robot in a game. Everyone, regardless of their conclusion, regardless, they contradict their conclusion by making prisons and court system and punishing people, such as thieves, murderers, etc. They're actually contradicting what they say. Because you actually now, by making a justice system, admit that a person is responsible for his action. That's why you give him fines. Hey, excuse me, why are you walking without a mask? Give me your ID. $200 fine. Why? Because you chose to walk without a mask and you jeopardize our life. I'm not doing it. I'm the robot. The creator of the world wrote the day I came to the world that today, in this day, at 2 p.m., I will walk in King's Highway without a mask. Do I have a choice? So the policeman say, you're right, the same creator of the world wrote that at 2 p.m. I will come and give you a ticket. And there's no end to that. Everybody would blame Hashem. Why are you like this? He's such a nasty person. What do you want from me? Do you think I like it? Ask him. He now told me to curse. He told me to shoot. Of course, nobody believes in it. It's nonsense. Everybody knows a person is fully responsible for his actions. So the Arabs, they say, God knows the future, but we do not have a choice. It's all min Allah. Everything is from God. Whatever happened, he did. So why are you chopping people's hands? Why are you stoning women who actually did some immodest things? Why stone them to death? Why you want to make a bomb in Iran that you can throw it on people and kill millions of people because you don't like their ideology? If it's all min Allah, let Allah handle it. Why you need to execute people? The answer is because one way or the other, either they are very, very stupid, but they don't understand what they say, or they're just liars. One of the two. You choose which one. But it doesn't add up. What does the Torah say? Hashem knows the future, and we are fully choosing what to do. And his knowledge about the future does not interfere with our choice. And I have a whole lecture about it. Let's not go there. It's going to take an hour now to explain. I have a lecture, free choice. Listen to it. You have all the explanations over there and the sources. So let's move on. So the Greeks, they tell the Jews, we are not here to hurt you. We don't want to kill one Jew here. That's not what we came here. We just want to release you. Release you from the old-fashioned ways of your fathers. We want you to be like us. Look at us. Look at the gel in our hair. Look at our muscles. Look at the stadiums we build. Don't you want to have a life? Don't you want a college degree? Look, we made universities. You're going to come there. Don't worry. It's all on us. You don't have to pay. We're going to give you a bachelor degree and a master degree and a PhD. And you will be professor. And if you really be good, we'll send you to Athens. And over there, you're going to be maybe the Caesar of Greece one day. And we're going to give you a green card. And we will give you unemployment for the rest of your life if you ever lose your job. And you can run for Senate. Democracy. We believe in freedom. Freedom. That's the Greeks. Just one condition. We want you to be loyal to us. Take off this thing from your head and these stupid things that comes out of your shirt. Take off your beard and write on the horn of your ox, which was like a cow, you know, people walk with that. Write on that you declare that you do not have a share in the God of Israel. And after that, we'll give you a permit. Nobody can touch you. You, what we call mityaven. You became officially Greek. You're now American, Baruch Hashem. Don't worry. You joined the Communist Party. What do you think happened? First thing they did, they made a stadium in Jerusalem. It's Stadion Teddy. For soccer games, for competition, running. They made a stadium in Jerusalem. And Jews started slowly, slowly, between lessons in yeshivot, wanted to go to see what's up. Wow, you don't understand, Moishale. I went the other day, they're so amazing, these Greeks. You have to see how they run. You have to see how they throw the spear. You have to see what muscles they have. Look at us and look at them. Look at our bellies. Look at us. We barely can run. Look at what muscles they have. You have to see it once. Why do I care about this nonsense? We're learning Nagmara here. We're connected to Hashem. No, no, one time you should go. Trust me, you're going to bless me. One time you go. Slowly, slowly, Jews went from the yeshivot to their universities, to the games, to the university, little by little. Started to get involved with them. And then they started to say, homosexuality and feminism is a wonderful development to humanity. And then they started to say, there's nothing wrong with having gay students in the class. They are perfectly normal. You have to accept them as regular kids. But what about our children that are brainwashed with this nonsense in yeshiva? We pay tons of money for them. No, you're not allowed to send them to different schools. That's not, it's perfectly kosher. Where all these ideas came from? From this poison. This poison that they put 2,200 years in the world is still, it's like a venom of a snake. So what happened? This Antiochus the Fourth, they came over there and made decrees. When was that? 2,167 years ago. Almost 2,200 years ago. What was the decree? The decree was the Jews are not allowed to keep Shabbat. Not allowed to keep Shabbat. Not allowed to do Brit Milah. And also not allowed to declare Rosh Chodesh. Why? Because they want to interfere with the actual foundations of Judaism. Once you break this, that's it, you break the religion. They started to make all kinds of decrees. People used to walk with tefillin all day back then, on the street, all day, not just in shul. People walk in the street, everyone had tefillin on. So they made a decree, no one is allowed to walk with tefillin. Anyone that we will catch with tefillin on his head, we will poke his brain out. That's how cruel they were. My mama said there was one tzaddik, Elisha, and they call him, there's a miracle that Hashem made for him. Elisha Baal HaKnafayim. So the question is, David HaMelech 3,000 years ago gave us a hint about Purim and Hanukkah. Purim was a decree on the body. To kill all Jews, Haman. Kill all Jews, religious, not religious, men, women, doesn't matter. Children, everybody must die. The Greeks, we don't want to kill anyone. Just be like us. We won't touch you. We'll give you benefits. Just leave the religion. So we have two decrees. Decree on the body by Haman and the Persians. Decree on the soul by the Greeks. Where is the hint in Tehillim? David HaMelech wrote, "Hapach nishbar, v'anachnu nimlatnu." Pach, it's a trap. Hapach nishbar, pach, Purim, Chanukah. Pei, Purim, Chet, Chanukah. Twice there was a trap. Once against our bodies, and once against our souls. Both times, the trap broke, and we were able to escape. What else? In Megillat HaChashmonaim, there's a scroll that describes the days of the Chashmonaim. In that scroll, it talks about Nicanor. He was the general of Antiochus, the head of the army. He sent him with massive army to Jerusalem. And he killed a lot of people. It was a big war because of the merit, of the rebellion. And they made a big stage in Beit HaMikdash, the place where the Jews served Hashem, right there, where the prophets were, where Hashem said that that's going to be my house. Over there they slaughtered the pig. They took a pig and they knew how much the Jews despised this animal. They slaughtered it in the holiest place inside Beit HaMikdash. And they took the blood, mamash, where the Jews used to take the blood of the sheep when they sacrificed, to contaminate the entire place. And not only that, when they made all horrible decrees, like for instance, if a Jewish woman wants to get married, she must go through them to impurify her, that she won't be available only to her husband, and after they do what they do, Hashem Rachem, that's when she's allowed to get married. Meaning she cannot come to her husband as that he won't be her first. That's what they did. All of all decrees, we can live with such much horrible life. And you know, usually the Jewish nation needs the merit of the Jewish women. Ma'aseh b'zchut nashim tzadkaniot nigalu. In Israel, they got saved thanks to righteous women, and they will get saved again thanks to righteous women. Usually there's always some righteous woman behind, like Rachel Imenu, the women in Mitzrayim that gave their life to give birth. Thanks to that we were able to keep our nation. And who was the hero in this case? What was her name? What was the name? Yehudit. Yael is a different story. It's Israel. This is a different story. Don't get confused. Similar a little bit, but don't get confused. Who is Yehudit or Yehudis? Who was she? Very common name now today in Judaism. A lot of women, their name is Judy in English. Judy. Who was she? Who? Huh? See? We don't even know simple principles in our history. Who of you did that thanks to our, all of you sitting here now?
Sister.
Very good. We need teachers from school to teach us. She was the sister of Yehuda Maccabi, the daughter of Matityahu. They had five boys. And she was the sister, righteous girl. Yudi was a widow. Her husband died. And she was extremely beautiful, very pretty woman, which helped her to reach her goal. What was her goal? To release us from these monsters. They contaminate every Jewish girl before she gets married, and do horrible decrees, and everyone suffers, everyone is depressed. Most of the Jewish people became Greeks already. To get out of the suffering, they couldn't handle the pressure. Imagine the life. So, what did she do? She asked permission from her father to go to the camp, the base, where Holofernes, this Holofernes was nominated by Antiochus when they did the siege around Jerusalem. When they ambushed Jerusalem, he was in charge of the attack. The big general. And they had a base. They're right there by Jerusalem. She asked permission from her father to go on a mission to smuggle into the base. And to go, she had a plan. Because she was so pretty, what happened to a goy, Greek goy that sees such a pretty girl, he begins to lose his mind. Then she came to him, hi, how are you? Wow, nice to meet you. Please tell your soldiers not to hurt me. I just want to be around here. And he liked her very much. And what happened? He told the soldiers, she has permission to walk around here. Don't touch her. Right? So she said, anyway, my nation is destroyed. At least I want to save my life. Would you protect me? Would you protect me? He thought he won the lottery. Wow, such a beautiful woman come to me for protection, he said. Of course I will protect. Nobody touched her. You heard? Nobody touched her. So she became Baruch Hashem friends over there. She walks around for days. Everyone gives her respect. Listen to this plan. So mamash, they all liked her. And she had a character and she was very okay. So mamash, she hypnotized them. He desired her very much and offered her marriage. I want to marry you, he said to her. Since anyway you left your nation and you came to be with us, you're one of us now. I want to marry you. She said, of course, it's great, I'm so honored. But I need to go to the mikveh before. So please tell your soldiers not to bother me on the way to the mikveh because they all look at me and they're not so modest. So he said to the soldiers, nobody looked at her, let her do what she wants to do. One time he made a party, invited everyone, and he invited Yudis. What happened to a woman when you give her a lot of wine to drink? She also begins to lose her mind, right? That's why the Gemara says, if you see Isha Sota, if you see a woman that her husband took her to the Kohen, to Bet HaMikdash, to drink those water, that they write the name of Hashem, you should make like a vow that you don't touch the wine. What's the connection? I saw her, but I don't have to drink wine, because why is she there? You know why? Because you drank wine. That's how it starts in a bar. So, what can I get you to drink? Once, two, three, four. Shem Yerachem. So, he said, let me get her some good wine. And so she brought a lot of feta cheese. Feta, very salty, Israeli style. You know this Israeli style that you have in Costco over there?
Nuva.
Two for $12? Okay, Nuva. Okay. Nuva owned by Chinese now. Okay? So it's Chinese cheese, not Israeli. So it's full of salt, tons of salt. What happens when you eat something salty? Eat the Israeli seeds with the salt. What happens after 3 minutes? Your mouth is so dry, you need to finish 2 bottles of water. And it still doesn't help. Because it dries, the salt dries out all liquid. So she brought a lot of salt. And she gave it to him. And he enjoyed the cheese. And because he was thirsty, the wine that he brought for her, she was pouring for him. Drink, drink some more. He will help you against the salt. And what happens when you drink so many cups of wine? You fall asleep. Once she falls asleep, she pulled his sword out. In one shot, she chopped his head off, grabbed the head, put it inside the bag, and quickly went out. Remember, he told the soldiers not to bother her. So everyone was afraid to get into trouble. She walked with the head inside her bag. Nobody suspected anything. Only in the morning, when they saw he's not coming to check them out, the general, they found the body without the head, and they went to a major panic. They all escaped for their life. That's what happened to soldiers when their commander is dead. They don't know what to do. Nobody to give order, everyone said, I don't care what's going to happen, let me save myself. They all started to run. When she brought his head to her father, everybody got encouraged. She's better than us, our sister, the woman. Remember, it wasn't like today everyone is a feminist. Back then women didn't have that much rights like today. And go to school, it was a whole different world. She's greater than all of us. We are like cowards. We did nothing, and she risked her life like this. And she brought the head of the big general. Everybody got inspired. That's when Yehudah Maccabee said, Mila Hashem Elai, who is a servant of Hashem, come with me. There was only 400 people. In the beginning, it was only 5 brothers and Matityahu. That's it. Slowly, slowly, more brave Bachurei Yeshiva joined the war. And 20 years, Rabotai, 20 years, maybe it was a guerrilla war, I don't know. I don't know how they survived 20 years. 20 years. Chanukah. What's Chanukah? On the 25th day, on the 25th day of Kislev, it's Chanukah. Chanu, it's Park. Cafe, it's 25. Abbreviation of Chanukah, Chet, is 8. 8, Chet, Nerot, Ve'alacha, Kebet, Hillel. We have an argument, Bet Shammai and Bet Hillel, how you light the menorah. Bet Hillel say, first day 1, second day 2, every day you add a candle. Bet Shammai say the other way around. 8, 7, 6, you count how many days left. Bet Hillel say, no, we add with the days. We go up. Bet Shammai say, every day the holiday is more finished. So it's like we're upset that now we have less time and less and less. Both are very logical, but halacha is like vet ile. They say when Mashiach comes, we're going to light 8, 7, 6. We'll see. Let him first come, then we worry about that. I'm sure it's not going to be an argument tonight. That will be the least of our problems. One more thing we should know, always in Chanukah, in Shabbat of Chanukah, which parasha we read? Parashat Miketz. Always. Parashat Miketz, how many words you have inside the parasha? 2,025 words. 2,025 words. It's interesting. In Chanukah, we light candle for 8 days. Right? How much is candle in numeric value? Ner? 250 times 8 is how much? 2,000. Plus 25 days of the rest of the month, right? Of Kislev. 25 days. 2,025. It's very interesting. From the beginning of the month, 25 days. In the time of Anshei HaKnesset HaGdola, there was Ezra HaSofer that came from Bavel, from Iraq. They are the ones who came to build the second temple. Ezra, Nehemiah, they brought some people. Who sponsored the work? The Persian king of Persia in those days, Koresh. A lot of Persian Jews, their name is Koresh. Kurosh, Koresh. Right? Why Jews would call themselves after the name of a king? Huh? Do you know any Jew that would call his son Sleepy Joe? Or Hussein Obama? Maybe the liberals, yeah. But a normal person, you know any Jew will call his son Paro? Achashverosh? Haman? We have Herzl, Nimrod, Hashem Yirachem, they don't know. But those famous kings, nobody called himself after a name. So how come a lot of Jews call themselves Alexander, especially the Russian, Alex, Alex, what's your name? Alex, Alex, Alex. Everywhere you go, Alex. What happened? That actually has a source in the Gemara. That Alexandros Mokdon, when he came to Israel, he saw Shimon HaTzadik, that was in HaKnesset HaGdola, Shiarei HaKnesset HaGdola. And he said, every night before I go to sleep, I see like an image of a holy man. That's the man. Because they were on the way, the Reform Jews of those days, the traders, instigate between the religious Jews to the Babylonians. Say, well, they speak against you, the very racist, you should go and kill the Beit HaMikdash. The lefties of those days is nothing different than today. Just today they have more power with the media, but the same nature, traders, snake, go undercover and cooperate with the enemies. Go destroy the temple. Who encouraged them to come destroy the temple? Those Jews. When Alexander saw Shimon HaTzadik, the Gemara say, he saw all the Jews came with torches to welcome him. He came out of his horse and he bowed down to him. The Babylonian soldiers, they went crazy. You bow down to this Jew, what's going on here? Every night before I go to sleep, I see the image of this holy man, and that's the man. So he say, I heard that you are doing bad things and speaking bad about us. He say, absolutely not. Say, okay, so I want you to put this statue of mine inside your Beit HaMikdash to prove loyalty, and we won't touch you. They can't bring a statue into Beit HaMikdash. So the rabbi was very clever, Shimon HaTzadik. He's saying, I have something better to prove to you that we, much better than to put a piece of rock in Beit HaMikdash. From now on, every Jewish boy that will be born this year, I'm making a decree, they will all be called Alexander. After you. You would do such thing? Yes. Forgot about the statue. That's how he fooled him. That's how the name Alex became a very common Jewish name. Also the Goyim. But the Jews, it's a Goy name, Alexander, Alex. Nothing to do with Judaism. But to save the destruction of the temple, they agreed to call their children Alexander. Now you know how this name arrived to our nation. Anyway, Rabotai, Ezra Sofer.
Alexander.
Which one? Oh, yes, right. So in the time of the last prophets of the Jewish nation, who are they? Who were the last prophets? Haggai, Zechariah, Zachary, Malachi, Malachi, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah, Nehemiah, and Mordechai. Who is Mordechai? Mordechai Tzadik. He knew how many languages Mordechai knew?
70.
Why? Everyone that is a member of the Sanhedrin must know 70 languages. Today, in Belgium, when I was there, average Belgian Jews know 6 languages, I think. They speak Flemish, they speak French, speak English, speak Hebrew with Israeli accent, which is very interesting. When they spoke Hebrew, I thought the Israelis.
Dutch.
Much like that.
Dutch.
Not Dutch. English, I say, and Yiddish. So 5 languages. Yiddish, Flemish, French, Hebrew, and English. 5. But fluent. Not like in Israel, you go to... How many languages you speak? 3 languages. What? Arabic, English, and Hebrew. Hebrew he speaks. English 5 words, Arabic 2 words. Not like this. They actually do speak 5 languages fluent. You can have a whole conversation. Imagine 70 languages. 70, when do you have the time to learn 70 languages? So, why the rabbis of the Sanhedrin has to know 70 languages? Since when we care about secular studies? They're all Talmidei Chachamim, they know Torah. Who cares if they speak Russian or not? If they speak French or not? If they speak German or not? Or English? Who cares? Or Spanish? Who cares what language they speak? The answer is, when you come to a trial, they have to understand the original language. Why? Because the interpreter, sometimes by mistake, translate the word a little bit different. And even one mistake in translating the words can turn the entire ruling of the judgment of that tribe. So you have to know exactly what they speak in the original language. So those prophets, they saw that the Jewish people have very strong desire, like the world has desire, to idol worshiping. Nobody can resist this desire. People go to all kinds of ceremonies and things. Oh, I have a sick boy. I was promised that if I go to that place, the boy tomorrow will be all brand new. And they saw that nobody, they can't stop the nation. Avodah Zarah everywhere. Avodah Zarah. So the Chachamim, they pray day and night to Hashem to cancel the Avodah Zarah. Once they cancel the Avodah Zarah, something new became in style. What was it? Philosophy. Okay, so now we don't have any more Avodah Zarah. We don't go to ceremonies. What's to do? Philosophy. That's how it all started. Philo means will, ratzon. Sophia means yeda, philosophia, philosophy. And that's it. And just before we finish and we move on, Hanukkah is one out of 7 decrees that the Chachamim made. We have 613 commandments in the Torah, just like the organs and the ligaments. 248 organs, 365 ligaments. 248 positive commandments, 365 restrictions. And how many mitzvot de Rabbanan? 7. Which one? Who can tell me by heart the 7 mitzvot de Rabbanan?
Amot.
think we should go to pre-1A and start all over again. Huh? One, that everything you eat, you have to do bracha, blessings of the food. The only bracha that you have to do from the Torah is Birkat Hamazon, blessing on the bread. Amotzi lechem min haaretz. And Birkat Hamazon. Amotzi lechem is the Rabbanan. But the Birkat Hamazon, when you finish to eat bread, when you finish to eat bread, you have to do Birkat Hamazon, and that's an application from the Torah. As it's written, V'achalta, V'savata, U'verachta. Not U'verachta, U'verachta. It's a command. Right? U'verachta means you used to bless Hashem. U'verachta, and you should bless Hashem. By the way, remember last week I told you that two Ashkenazim sent me an email that they complained. How do you know which way is the correct way? I forgot that minute last week when I spoke that actually in last week Parasha, Rashi, which was the father of all the Ashkenazim, he was French, spoke Yiddish. Rashi was a big Ashkenazi, the biggest Parshan on the whole Torah and Talmud, the greatest ever live, Rashi. Without Rashi, what do you understand from Judaism? Without Rashi and Rambam, we are finished. Take Rashi and Rambam out of Judaism, it's like you had a Rolls Royce with no wheels. What good is that? Can't move anywhere. So, the point is that Rashi himself is talking about Rachel. Rachel, Ba'a, and Ba'a, it's two different times. Present and past. So Mil'el and Mil'ra in grammar change the meaning of the words. That's Rashi, which was what? Ashkenazi. Chabad Shai forgot to say it to those two. To tell them, look in today's parsha, then you may change your mind that even Ashkenazi has grammar. It's not something Sfaradi. It's something Jewish. It was given to us in Har Sinai when we got the Torah. But some people, I guess, I don't know, they want to turn things into politics. Chaval. So, let's move on. So the seven mitzvot of the Chachamim is blessings on the food, netilat yadayim, when you eat bread. Why you have to make netilat yadayim? Why only when you eat bread you have to do netilat yadayim? Why when you eat a cake you don't do netilat yadayim? Why when you drink water you don't have to do netilat yadayim? Huh? Why? In the old days, when Bet HaMikdash existed, when the Kohanim has to eat the Truma, they have to be pure. Their hands have to be pure. They have to wash their hands to do Netilah that they eat with purity. After the temple was destroyed, the Chachamim figured in one or two generations, no one would remember to wash their hands before they eat. So when Bet HaMikdash will be built one day, no one will remember that you're not allowed to eat before you wash your hands. So we are making a decree that all Jews must wash their hands when they eat bread. Why? Like this, it will be a way of life. So if Bet HaMikdash will be built in 100 years, or 500 years, or 1,000 years, there is no fear of forgetting. Why? Because it's a way of life. Father teaches son, son teaches son, and everybody teaches the next generation, and everyone washes their hands, just like today, after 2,000 years, everyone does it. So that's a kana of Netilat Yadayim. Third, Iruvin. Eruvin, all Masechet Eruvin comes from one decree, to do Eruv. Eruv, Chatzerot, Eruv of the area, to make the entire area that you can be metaltel. It's different Eruvin. All Chumin, Eruv Chumin. Very good. Fourth one, Halel. Halel, the Halel. Chachamim, they made it in the holidays to say Halel. Fifth one, candle of Shabbat and Yom Tov. Ba'adlik Nerot. Ba'adlik Ner shel Shabbat and Yom Tov. Sixth, reading of the Megillah. Kriyat HaMegillah. And seven, Hanukkah. Hanukkah. Oh, like the Hasidic say, Hanukkah. But I'll tell you a joke. When I was in Yeshiva, you know, we are Israelis. Hanukkah in Hebrew means to choke someone. To choke someone. So, chenek. To choke someone. The way the Hasidim say Hanukkah, it's Hanukkah, meaning to choke. So the Israelis, they didn't know anything from Hasidim. They came to America, they all became Baalei Tshuva. They come to Yeshiva, and there was one Rebbe, big Rebbe over there, that he was actually on the building. The Yeshiva was renting the place for him. So every Hanukkah, he used to light in the middle of the learning, when everyone is learning, because we light an hour before the Hasidim. We light shortly after sunset. The Hasidim, they daven Mincha an extra hour after sunset.
72.
Rabbeinu Tam. So he light like an hour after we already finished lighting and we went back to learn Gemara. So he comes, and remember everybody scream with Gemara, and he comes and he's screaming, you know, like he's a Rebbe. You know how the Rebbe scream and they light? So he said, Le'adlik ner shel Chanukah. Now these Israelis never heard that in their life. They were all falling on the floor because for them, Chanukah means to choke someone. But this is the price we are paying for being in exile 2,000 years. That every nation speaks in a different Havara. The Litvish, Yemenai, Sfaradim, Hasid, everybody. Even between the Hasidim, depending where you're from. You're from Yerushalayim, you're from there, you're from there. Well, you see that the more we were moving from one place to the other, the more different accents and all kinds of abbreviations pronunciation came into our language. That when Mashiach came, it's going to be very interesting to see how the rest of the people will accept it. Let me give you an example. What would happen if the Mashiach will be Hasidish? All the Litvish Bnei Torah will go crazy. How can it be? Mother, which tied all day like this, in the end is a Hasid. If it will be Litvish, the Hasidim, how can it be, Mother? If it will be Sfaradim, both of them will say, Ma, it cannot be. If it will be Temani, everybody is Temani, from everyone, Temani. Hashem will have to find someone that is a quarter of each. Quarter Hasidish, quarter Yiddish, quarter Sfaradi. Hopefully everyone will accept it. But then someone told me, no, you're too naive. Then no one will accept it. No, that's a little bit joking. Let's get serious. Baruch Hashem. So this is the story of Hanukkah. Of course, there's a lot more to say. Go to previous years. I have many lectures about the topic. You can get some extra knowledge there. So, we see in Parashat Vayishlach a few things that we have to focus on. Something is a little bit strange. We have the Bechir Avot, the great father, Yaakov Avinu, from all three fathers. The most superb one, the Gemara says, Bechir Avot, Yaakov Avinu. His name was changed. His name was changed to Israel. Abraham, his name was not changed to Israel. Also Yitzchak. Why Yaakov is a little bit better than the other two fathers? Why? If the Gemara would have said it, who are we to say such things, God forbid, to compare between big holy people? The Gemara says, Yaakov is Bechir Avot. The question is why? Why? The answer is nobody bad came out of him. Everyone that came out of him was a tzaddik. Abraham, Ishmael came out of him. Ismail came out of him. Yitzchak, Esav came out of him. Yaakov, everyone that came out of him was good. Baruch Hashem. In that case, the question is screaming. How Yaakov Avinu is worried about Esav? I don't get it. You already have a promise from Hashem that he will protect you. you have nothing to be afraid of because Hashem has already promised you that he's with you. Esav is coming to you with 400 men, 400 mercenaries. Where Esav has 400 soldiers from? Did he join the Marines? No, it's like Hezbollah. They pay money and Muslims from all over the world come and join them. It's not Lebanese or it's from all different countries. Mercenaries. They get paid by the month. It's a job for them. Training, this, shooting, bothering Israel. They get paid for it. So Esav comes with an army of 400 men on the way to Yaakov. And Yaakov is shaking, very worried, afraid. The question becomes even harder when you see that the Torah said that Yaakov sent angels to check what's the story with Esav. Is he angry? Is he coming for peace? Is he coming for war? Is he coming by himself? Is he coming with other people? Should I be worried? Should I not be worried? Meaning Yaakov has the ability to take angels, assign them to send them on a mission. Rashi writes Malachim Mamash. The word Malachim means messengers. What kind of messengers? It can be human, it can be angels. But it's messengers. If it's human, of course, human is human. They have their limitation. But if you're able to send real spiritual angels to check Esav, why don't you just tell the angels, chop his head off if he's going to say a word? If you have such an ability and the angel serving you, what are you worried about?
Maybe he was afraid that Esav also had the merits of the fathers. About Rabbi Yitzchak.
The last I heard, Esav did not graduate Ponovich. So even if his father was a big rebbe, not exactly the boy that is going to take his place. And says, well, yes, you have tzaddik and you have rasha. It's tzaddik against the righteous against wicked here. Why would the wicked have a merit to kill the righteous? Rav Chetzke Levenstein, the Mashgiach, this is what he says. He says, a person should learn one very important principle in life. Never, ever trust your status. Today you're tzaddik. A minute ago Hashem spoke to you and said, I love you, you're great. I'm with you, I'm happy from you, you're great tzaddik. That's today. What's tomorrow? It's a whole new day. Don't lay down and say, I'm good, I'm set. Hashem loves me, I'm in good hands, I'm protected. No, no, no. Things can change by the blink of the eye. In a minute, a person can lose his olam haba. In 1 second. I'll give you a proof. A person was religious 90 years, learned Torah non-stop, Gaon Mivilna, 90 years, did not leave the land. Then, God forbid, before he dies, he said one sentence, which take 10 seconds, and he lose everything. All his mitzvot in 1 second. If he say, I regret all the mitzvot that I kept all my entire life, I wish I would not do it, something like that. In 1 second, everything he gained, he lost. Everything. In 1 second, 9 years of struggle, waking up at 4 a.m., mikveh in the ices, breaking the ice, going into the mikveh, 20 below zero, winds, ice. The Ramchal became deaf in 1 ear from going to the mikveh at 4 a.m. in Italy, in Padova. Taking a stick, walking on the ice, barefoot, without clothes, wind, killer wind, like a knife, 4 a.m., dark, walking on ice, breaking the ice, was very skinny, like this tripod. The Ramchal was very, very skinny. He broke the ice and went into the mikveh, and because the water was so cold with pieces of ice, he became deaf in 1 ear. This is the Ramchal, Mitzato, Mesilat Yesharim, Path to the Just. This is the kind of devotion people had. It's only 200 years ago. Not talking 2,000 years ago here. It's 7 generations. 7 generations, that's it. In Italy, in Padova. So, if a person say, God forbid, I regret all the mitzvot I kept, the Gemara calls it Tohe al-Rishonot. Wondering, did I do the right thing or not? The fact that you already said in your mouth that you regret being religious, in 1 minute you lose 90 years of gaining.
Can you do true for that thing?
So the question is, why did Hashem give such an opportunity to lose what you gain in 90 years of such hard work to lose it in 10 seconds? It's not fair. It's not fair to let a person in a moment of stupidity. We're not angels. We have some moments of stupidities in life. Right? So in a moment of stupidity, a person would lose 90 years of hard effort? How did God allow such a thing?
On the other hand, we can gain everything back.
The answer is there was no other way. Because the way Hashem made the world is in a system of justice. אני אל האמת והצדק אשר לא יישא פנים ולא ייקח שוחד. I do not get bribed from anyone and I do not twist the truth in a trial to any side. Not to the righteous side and not to the wicked side or not to anyone because nobody can offer me any bribe. So, if a person was wicked all his life, not Shomer Shabbat, not pulling tefillin, eating not kosher, all day gossip, hurting people with his mouth, stealing, everything he has, it's all stolen. Selling drugs to kids, killed thousands of them by now. All his body is full of tattoos, earrings, chilul Hashem, the way he dressed, the sins that he made with the women all his life. He's container is loaded with billions of sins. And now he's 80 years old. Barely opened up his eyes. Now, he comes and says, I'm so ashamed of my life. When I look back at my life, I wish I can be reborn and go into yeshiva from a young age and learn and become like these holy boys that I look around them in the street, how they are pure. I feel so bad about my life. So he said, God, please forgive me for everything I've done. I want to be righteous. I want, from this moment on, that's it. No more sins. These Shabbos, I will keep. Tomorrow morning, I'm putting tefillin. As of now, not one bad word about any human being. From this second, I don't put anything in my mouth unless it's kosher. And from this moment on, I'm going into yeshiva, I sit and learn until I die. And 2 minutes later, he got a heart attack and died. Before he ate anything, before he learned anything, before he kept any Shabbat, and before he ever put tefillin. Now what do you do with someone like this? 8 years was almost like a mass murderer. So many people got hurt from him. So many sins he made. Where are you going to even start fixing it? Now, 1 minute of repentance from a broken heart with some tears, and he died. What are you doing? What are you going to do with it? There's actually a case like this in the Gemara. There is a case like this in the Gemara. It happened. There was one horrible, despicable, very not modest human being. His name was Elazar ben Dordaya. Elazar. Today, someone like that, we will call him Eli in Israel. What's up, Eli?
Eli.
What was his specialty? He was a womanizer. Every horrible woman that makes sins with men for money, not for money, he visited her. He was going, crossing rivers. Oh, there is one over there. Oh, over there I wasn't yet. Tomorrow I'm going over there. Going just to make sins with the women. One time, one of these low-life women, she told him, ugh, you a Jew? Look what became out of you. Look at you. How you became such a low life. How you became Bernie Sanders. Look at you. of God. Look what came out of you. Enemy of everything that God loves. Everything you love, he hates. Everything he hates, you love. What's going on? How a Jew becomes so corrupted? He left them, came out. This prostitute gave him Musa. She ripped his heart to pieces. Imagine this. She gives him Musa. He went, he sat by the mountains and started to cry, screaming, crying with a broken heart. He said, mountains, please ask mercy on me, the birds, everything, you know, like went crazy. He cried so bad until he died from crying, from a broken heart. I don't think it ever happened in history, such thing. A person would cry out of regret that he's so wicked, and he was so ashamed, and he regretted everything he had done. So he was crying with such a broken heart, asking God to forgive him, until he died from crying. I imagine he got a heart attack. Who knows what happened to him? The Gemara say, that second there was an announcement in the court of heaven, Rabbi, Elazar ben Dordaya is welcome to heaven, to life of eternity. Why is it? Rabbi Elazar ben Dordaya, one time he didn't open Gemara in his life. Every day was making sins with all these goyot over there. How all of a sudden he became a rabbi? You want to forgive him? You want to say that he got saved from hell? Okay, there's ways to say it. But why are you, next thing, you make him a rebbe. What's going on? From the worst, the unspeakable Jew, he became all of a sudden a rebbe? In a minute? In an hour? In 5 hours? Whatever that took? The answer is, the level of repentance that he made was really extraordinary. If we cry, most likely we won't die. Most of the crying we did in our life was for selfish personal reasons, not for regret and repenting against what we have done. When we cry, even on Yom Kippur, when we cry, do we really cry from shame? How we were so ungrateful to God and made so many millions of sins this past year? Nah. We cry because we know that we paid the price and we lost our parnassah and we lost our marriage and we lost the child, or who knows what happened, everyone with his problems. So it's a mixture of crying about my suffering, again, about my situation, knowing in the back of my mind that the reason I'm so desperate and so buried in so many problems is because of all these horrible things I've done. So when I cry about my sins, it's not that I regret that I made them. I regret that I got punished for them. That's really what we're crying for, if we're really honest with ourselves. Why? Because if God would come that second and say to you, dear Moshe, I like you. Don't worry. This year, you can continue as what you've done. I'm giving you this free pass. Take it. You're never gonna get another punishment from now on. Here. Take it. That's it. Here. It's my signature. Stamp. No more cancer. No more kids in drugs. No more problems in a marriage. No more your partner steal millions from you. No more FBI investigation. No more drug addictions. No more depression, no more panic attacks, no more high sugar, no more surgeries, no more court cases, no more lousy neighbors with his dogs all day making you crazy. None of these things. You are free from it. And Sleepy Joe will be a president. So he can be a happy, happy resident. That second. Would you be able to continue to cry about your sins? Or will you go out of the room smiley and happy? Huh? Right away you grab your phone. So what are you doing, Moshe? It's Yom Kippur. You don't know who I am. You don't know who you're talking to. Shh. Don't give me Musa. Hey, What's up, brother? Whoa, it's still Yom Kippur in America. Why are you calling me? Don't worry, I have to tell you what happened. I couldn't wait 7 hours. Tomorrow he's going to make a press conference. Wow, he already walks around. Hey, you, who are you? You're Rosh Yeshiva here? Get out of here. I'm the new Rosh Yeshiva here. Don't know who I am. It will be 100 times worse than the past year. And one thing for sure, next Yom Kippur, he won't even come to cry. He has a ticket. True or false?
True.
100% true. So why we are crying? Not because we are ashamed. Not because we regret for doing what Hashem told us not to do. We upset and regret because we know, no matter how liberal and modern we are, and no matter how many times we criticize the speakers that say the truth, that we are paying for our sins and we're being punished, they get angry when they hear it. But all of them know he's right. There's not one Jew in the world that thinks that the Holocaust was a prize. Everybody knows it was a punishment. They deceive, they lie, they say, we don't know, God doesn't punish, baloney, enough with your nonsense. There's not one person in the world that thinks that it was such a gift. And if someone would think that it's a gift, put him in a mental institution, because it's not normal. Everybody knows we got punished. For what? We can argue. There's millions of possibilities. But for sure, it wasn't a prize. So the idea is the same thing about our personal life. You look at the way your kids turn. This one divorced, this one is a drug addict, this one is depressed all day, this one waking up at 12. And you already want to take me already from this miserable life. So when you come to Yom Kippur and you cry about your situation and you know that your sins brought you to here. So you really, it's a mixture of crying a little bit for your sin, but most of the crying is for the way that you're thinking, how do I come out of this mess? That's really the crying is. I remember in 2008, what is it, 12 years ago, there was one very big famous billionaire, tycoon of real estate. He's also very generous, he gives a lot of charity. One of my students used to live in his house temporarily. The yeshiva was close to this billionaire's house. And he was sleeping there in one of the rooms. And Yom Kippur, they prayed together. But there was already few Yemei Kippur that he prayed with this billionaire. Few. But in 2008, when everything crashed, you remember what happened? All the banks went bankrupt, real estate crashed 40, 50%. People lost tens of millions, hundreds of millions of dollars. People basically lost 30 years of efforts in 1 year. So he came to me after Yom Kippur, that boy. He said to me, I never saw this billionaire in my entire life crying like this nonstop, like he cried this Yom Kippur. You had to see how he was crying. Why was he crying? He lost tens of millions of dollars that year. Another year like this, he's going to be homeless. With all his fancy name. He got very nervous. Why the previous years he didn't cry like that? There was no reason to cry. Why you don't cry like this for your sins? Because we're not in this level. When did he cry? For the year that he lost almost all his wealth. And since then until now, he's only smiling. He's becoming a lot wealthier than before. With this old, maybe now Corona, maybe it's a new thing now. We'll see this Yom Kippur what's going to happen. But in general, you get the point. The point is that most of our crying is for selfish reasons. But this Rabbi Elazar ben Dordaya, his crying was not for selfish reasons. He didn't care about the situation. He actually realized all the sins he's made. And he cried for such a broken heart, that was a perfect tshuva. And Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi cried and said, Yesh Adam Kone Olamo Berega Echad. A person can buy his next world in one moment. But he can also lose it in one moment. And the reason that Hashem made such a thing, that a person can be religious all his life and in 1 minute lose everything, because he wanted to give us an option that if we were wicked all our life, we will be able to do tshuva in 1 minute and save our entire life. And the only way to do it was for the Satan to agree. It has to be a justice system. So he said to the Satan, Hashem, I'll make such a system that a person can become religious and righteous in 1 day, but he can also lose everything in 1 day. Ele keneged ele parasha, has to be balanced. So the only way we can do tshuva after making horrible sins for 80 years, in 1 day all of a sudden we can be big tzaddikim if we really do tshuva, is only because there is an option to the Satan to grab you in 1 moment and make you lose all your life. And I will give you 1 or 2 examples. What happened if a person did not declare that he regret being religious? He did not declare. How can he lose his olam haba in a moment? Very simple. Before he dies, he has, let's say, $50 million. And no children, he writes the check to a donation to a specific organization. Which organization? Reform. Promoting gay marriage, promoting everything Hashem hates. Someone told me today, he was driving in a car in Israel, and he heard on a commercial on the radio, if you are a religious woman, who got tired of religious life and looking for a way out, call us. We will walk you through the entire process of leaving your religious family and husband and children. Come to us. We will give you money, a place to live, and direction how to succeed as a free secular woman. Where they have so much money to offer, you know how much money it will cost to take a religious girl and give her a place to live and money to live? Every person will be thousands of dollars every year. For that, there is plenty of donations. George Soros and all his friends waiting online. How much you need? The Satan has a lot of soldiers. Put a commercial on the radio. Help Rabbi Mizrachi to save more souls. We need to take people out, pay their debt, bring them to yeshiva, help them for a year to survive, relocate their family to a religious neighborhood. It will cost fortune. Come and help! Now one person will come. You don't believe me? Put a commercial. If one person will come, I'll pay you for the advertising. You see, now one person will call. Try it. Not me. Put anybody that does good thing, like real quick evil. Help that person to save more souls. Nobody will come. But for the Satan, people wait online. Fighting. Who should give them money? And they hunt naive girls. And then all of a sudden, they run away. This guy comes home, they see, well, what happened? That's what they do. It happens all the time. So now, if a person leaves all his money to a horrible cause, that second he lost his olam haba, because it just shows who he is. That's who you give all your money, that you save all your life, to people that will fight against God? In 1 minute, you lose everything. Or the other way around. Let's say you're not so righteous, not so religious. But before you die, you had $50 million and you what? I want to give this to Rabbi such and such and to use it only to save souls or to put boys in yeshivot or kids that their family cannot afford yeshiva to pay for their tuition, only for that. In 1 second, you bought yourself billions of mitzvot for the next year. In 1 second. That's called Yesh Adam Kone Olamo Berega Achad. You just wrote in a will by the lawyer. All my money go to do such and such and such. You got eternal, wonderful life. You wrote it to the reform or conservative or other kinds of low lives. And what happened? Immediately you lost everything. In 1 minute. Yesh Adam Kone Olamo Berega Achad. Yesh Adam Me'abed Olamo Berega Achad. Rabbi Yehudah HaNasi, why did he cry? He should have been very happy that a Jew that was so wicked and filthy in 1 hour became so righteous that they announced that he's a rabbi, because all his sins turns into mitzvot. So why Rabbi Yehudah HaNasi cried? He did not cry for him. He cried for himself. I give my life to Hashem and to Torah for 120 years. He lived 120 years. And if you ask me if I know for sure that I go to heaven, I have no idea. Maybe yes, maybe not. I'm shaking. I don't know. Only Hashem knows. So he already got it in one day. And I have to walk 120 years non-stop, hoping to get there. How can I not cry? It's a very good reason to cry. So back to our question. Why Yaakov Avinu is afraid of Esav? Something here doesn't add up. What is it? First of all, don't forget that Yaakov was strong just as much as Esav. If they were going to a fist fight, believe me, one was Kung Fu, the other one was Jiu Jitsu. Meaning Yaakov was very strong. All the shepherds could not move the stone from the well. Yaakov with one hand moved it. That means it was very powerful. It wasn't, you know, like this skinny bachurei shiva. You go like this, and you fall on the floor. Get up. Don't make wings here. Very skinny, doesn't eat. All day he learns. Torah matishat adam. The Torah makes a person very weak. Yaakov was very strong, very powerful. So what is he afraid of? Esau is going to give him a punch, or give him another punch, can kill him. It's not going to end bad for you, good for Esau. No matter how you look at it, something here doesn't add up. The Mashgiach Rav Chetzke Levin should say, from Yaakov you have to learn. He's righteous, yes. He's from a royal family, yes. He has chut avot, yes. He suffered non-stop in his life, full of suffering. Hashem gave him a personal guarantee. I'm with you, I'm watching you, you're okay, you have nothing to be afraid of? Yes. And what is he doing? The Gemara says he was shaking. Why? Maybe I made a sin that turned everything around against me. Meaning righteous people live with constant fear that the next sin I will do will turn my status from righteous to wicked. Just like the Rambam writes. Every person has to look at himself as he is 50-50. He is going to make a sin, will turn his scale to the negative side, and the whole world was 50-50, so now the whole world went to a negative side. So that sin that he just made turned him to negative and turned the entire world to negative. If he just committed a mitzvah, a good deed, he turned the scale to the positive side and turned the entire world to the positive side. Meaning that mitzvah that you did actually now potentially saved the entire world. And that's how Yaakov Avinu lived. When Hashem spoke to me, maybe I had at least one mitzvah more than the amount of sins that I had. So I was on a positive status. But since then it's been a few days, maybe I've done a few bad things and it comes into the negative, and all these promises are conditional. I messed up and Hashem will take back what he promised. Beautiful answer, but we still have one problem with that. We know what the Rambam writes, that when a prophet gives a prophecy, if the prophecy is bad, it doesn't have to happen. The day of the prophecy came, if the prophet say, on the 15 days of Shvat, there will be a massive hurricane that will knock down hundreds of buildings in the city as a punishment of all the wicked people that live there. 15th day of Shvat came, sunny day. The wicked people play matkot on the beach of Tel Aviv. What happened? Prophet. Prophet. It's a joke, what prophet? You really got scared from what the prophet said? Is this a sign that the prophet is false or no? No. Maybe X amount of people over there made tshuva. got scared, did tshuva, he turned everything to a positive side. The decree was postponed. What happened if the prophet gave a good prophecy? At this date, something great will happen. It will be 3 days of rain. That's a place that has never rained. 3 days of rain in a row. And it happened. What happened if it didn't happen? Then for sure it's a false prophet. Why yes? The answer, the rule is, the Rambam explained. If the prophet gives a good promise from Hashem, it must happen. No matter what you do. You became wicked, the people became wicked, the prophet promised this city will get something good, and this particular day they must get it. If he promised something bad and they didn't get it, that's not a sign that he's a bad prophet. Maybe people did some improvement and Hashem gave an extension. Based on that, if Hashem promised Yaakov good, and let's say he made the sin, like he's worried. How the good will be canceled? The answer, there is a difference between Hashem promising something to individual one-on-one to a prophet is sent by Hashem and give a message to the public. If the message was published to the public, that's going to be a very big chilul Hashem that it did not happen. So Hashem will never cancel a good promise. If they promise something good to the people of this community or city or country, it must happen. The sins that they did, since Hashem gave the prophecy until now, they're going to pay in a different way. But the good that I promised must happen. But between you and me, Hashem and Yaakov, no guarantees. I promise you everything, assuming that you will remain just as righteous as you are now. Tomorrow you become a liberal, you move from Trump to Sleepy Joe. How will I give you good? I can't look at you anymore. You became a Democrat. You pro-abortion? You pro-gay marriage? You pro-Iran? And you want me to give you all the blessings that I promise you? Of course not. What's the question? Now Yaakov, because he's a tzaddik, the more righteous you are, the more you worry about your actions. What's the proof? Rabbi Yochanan, before he passed, he was 120 years old. His student was standing around his bed and saw how he's shaking and crying. Shaking and crying. They ask him, Rabbi, why are you so afraid? He said to them, if I go now in front of a judge that is a human being, that you can bribe him somehow and buy him out, I would still be very scared and very worried. Now when I go to a trial in front of a king that you cannot buy and you cannot bribe, you expect me not to be worried. But this is a rabbi that learned Torah all his life and did not make sins. He was a very holy person. All his life was Torah, Torah, Torah. 10 of his sons died and he did not stop to learn Torah. He's a very holy rabbi. What can go wrong? The answer is, I learned Torah nonstop. I couldn't live without Torah. But maybe in my ideology, I was not 100% perfect. Ideology is very complicated. Among very religious rabbis, you have differences in ideology. Differences. You're going to take one from Chabad, one from Breslev, one from Satmer, one Sfaradi, one Litai, and let them write 500 answers about 500 questions, and you'll be shocked. How many differences you're going to find between Rav Avigdor Miller to the Chabadnik, to the Litvish, to the Chassid, to the Satmer? If you ask the Satmer about the Israeli state, field, the Shaim should give it to the Arabs and it should have never happened. Why? It's all communist, Zionist, wicked people who destroyed the Torah and destroyed the children and made them all goyim. Are they wrong? They're 1,000,000,000% right. So what Rav Ovadia Yosef will answer? He knows they're right, but he's not a fool. Every fool knows they're right. You see what they did to the generation in Israel. But the argument is not if they're right or wrong. Everybody that knows Torah and knows what Hashem loves and hates knows they're right. Rav Yoel Nisatmer was right 100% everything he said. The argument is now, after the fact. That's it. Now you have 7 million people living there. Third generations already. We are there now. We fought, we built buildings, we invested hundreds of billions of dollars. 24,000 people gave their life to be in the Holy Land. We have the Kotel, we have Yeshivot, we have so much Torah and so much Chesed. What are you suggesting? After all of that, we come, hey, Arafat, come. We want to give you a gift. Take Jerusalem, take the Yeshivot, take everything. Put us in Nebraska. Send us to Siberia. Is it realistic? Do you really think it's possible? In 1 minute, we'll be all dead. The minute you give them power, they'll take over the army, they'll take over the cities. No matter where we're going to be, we'll all be destroyed. Spiritually, it may get even worse. At least in Israel, you have a lot of Baalei Tshuva, a lot of Yeshivot, a lot of cities. There's a big war. But there's some Torah, there's synagogues everywhere. So the argument is not about if the Zionist Reshaim, they loved Torah. Of course they didn't love Torah. Of course they hated religion. Of course they were the enemies of Hashem. And of course they murdered hundreds of thousands of neshamot. We are their victims. We, the people who grew up in Israel, we are their victims. All these communist Reshaim. Until today, they're not stopping. You see how they talk in the Knesset, in the government. The argument is now, what's next? What's next? I'll give you an example. I gave once a Hasid Satmer, a Mashal, and he agreed with me, at least partially. I told him, we both agree that those people were very big, wicked people, right? But let me ask you a question. Let's say there is a Satmer Hasid. He comes to the Rebbe now. He said to the Rebbe, I want to open a pawn shop in Harlem. People come, I give them loans, I take collateral. I want to open a pawn shop in 125th Street in Harlem, the heart of Harlem. And my friend has something similar in another area. He makes very good living. I'm tired of living from food stamps. Enough. I want to support my 10 children with dignity. I have $200,000 that I saved after working for 20 years. I want to put it into that store, buy some merchandise, and go into business. The Rebbe say to him, and what's going to be about your soul? What are you going to do in Harlem? Do you have a shul there? Do you have minyanim over there? Do you have righteous people coming in and speaking some nice divrei Torah? Who are you going to be around? Now, one kosher Jew is not there. You don't have the atmosphere that a Jew that wants to be connected to Hashem will have. Harlem, Paris, King's Highway, doesn't matter. Place with no Torah, no holiness. So the Hasid heard what the Rebbe said as a recommendation. He anyway went and opened out the business. He opened the business, he put $200,000 there. Now Hashem is very upset with him. You go to the Rebbe gives you a good advice, try to save your neshama. Try to save you from losing your money, from investing in that horrible place. And what do? You go behind his back and you're still doing it. So what's the right thing to do? To take away all your money, make you bankrupt, and make you come to the Rebbe on your knees. Rebbe, forgive me, I went behind your back and I did it anyway. For Hashem should have given you a serious punishment. The problem that Hashem has now, it doesn't only look at you, you fool. What about your wife? What about your 10 children who learns in Talmud Torah and you have to pay tuitions for them? What about your father and mother? What about all your brothers and sisters? There's already more than 50 people that will be devastated if that's what's going to happen to you. So Hashem is actually forced to cooperate with your stupidity and your wickedness. Why? for the sake of your children. And that's exactly what happened in the state of Israel. These Zionist, communist, Reshaim, haters of Torah and Judaism, decided to become British and Americans and Germans and go into a war and start a war with the Arabs because we take Israel one way or the other, and they did. And Hashem made them a big miracle. Six-day war, it's the biggest miracle in the history of wars. Even in the Torah, when you read about wars, you didn't have such miracle. Besides Abraham Avinu went to fight with the kings, yes. But war, when we occupied Israel, it took 14 years. 14 years to divide the land. 7 years to fight the Goyim, and 7 years to divide the land. When we went to fight the Greeks, Yehudah Maccabi, 20 years it took. Not 6 day war, 20 years. One Israeli pilot told me that he went to some American base in Long Island. And they were learning over there about a no plane, something like that. And the teacher over there was talking about this war and that war, and the World War I, World War II, all different kinds of battles. American pilots, German pilots, Russian pilots. And the Israeli pilot asked him, excuse me, you talked about every possible war, but the greatest war in the modern history, that the Israeli Air Force destroyed seven Air Force of seven Arab countries within hours, knocked down hundreds of the planes, destroyed them almost with no casualty. Something that is unheard of in history, you did not say a word about it. We are learning here about tactics of war in Air Force. How you will keep avoiding the six-day war? Do you know what the guy answered him? The guy said, I am here to teach reality, not God's miracles. You, the Jewish people, God makes miracles for you. Against all these Arabs, tiny country, all of a sudden you win, you destroyed seven countries. Do you really think that that's what's going to happen to these pilots in their countries when they fight? I have to teach them the reality of flying. Not God's doing the job. So even that guy over there, the pilot, the American, I don't want to talk about the six-day war because you're not going to find any logic there. Everything there was God. Forget about it. Don't bring it up. That's my Israeli pilot. When he came back from there, and he wasn't even religious, this pilot. But he was so impressed by the answer. So, the question is, if God is so upset in his communists, this Reshaim, Ben-Gurion and their friends, how did he help them again and again and again against these Arabs? How does he help us again and again and again with America? How did he put Trump in power 4 years? He helped us with Iran, with this, with that, with all kinds of things. How did, when it looks that everything is about to go bad, a miracle happened and everything somehow turned around and again and again. That's when I told this Hasid. Once you already bought the pawn shop and you're there, every day Hashem will send you customers and will help you from those who wants to rob you with a gun and plan how to shoot you. And they do all these things. Why? Because you left him no choice. Because he's not going to put your children in the hand of this because he's stupid. So now you brought 7 million Jews into Israel. There's two options. To say to the Zionists, you're wicked, you hate my Torah, you destroy the religion, you want to make everyone in Israel go in, let you die in your own bloodshed. 7 million Jews will die in Israel, that will be the end of it. Did we deserve it? Those who wicked and started all the kibbutzim, maybe yes. But there are Moroccan Jews, what did they do? The Yemenites that came, what did they do? Some Hasidim that came later on. What did they have to do with the Zionists? They wanted to live in Holy Land. They found out Israel is a state. Let me go live in Bnei Brak. Let me live in Israel. So they all should die now. So the answer to the Satmar, with all my love to them, enough with this. There's no way to turn the wheel back. Now it's a new war. You have to fight the existing wicked people today that have no idea whatsoever what does it mean Zionism. Take an average Israeli in Israel. Ask him, Maze Tzionut. I give you anything you want if one of them will even know what it is. They don't even know what it means. Ask the Iranians what Zionism is, they all know. They know. Ask the Israelis today, 20 years old guys and girls in the street, Agidli, Maze Tzionut. No idea what you want from them. They have no idea. They're just wicked secular people. They raise them like goyim. They raise them to hate religion. There's nothing to do with those Zionists. Ben Gurion and his friends, they know Judaism. They know books. They know a lot. But they chose to be wicked. But these Israelis who are born, or Americans that are born here in New York, and make them reform, liberal, lefties, followers of Bernie Sanders, because they never heard in their life one word of Torah, one speech. What exactly they know from their life? What do they know? Like the Rambam writes about the Karaites, and their parents forced it on them, and they grew up like that, and there's nothing else they know. So the conclusion of what I say here, Rabotai, and Ramash time is running out soon, the conclusion is, today I'm righteous, it doesn't mean I'll be righteous tomorrow. Rabbi Yochanan was shaking. Then the student told him, if you're such a holy man, maybe you give us a blessing before you leave us. So he told him, I'm giving you a blessing that you fear God like you fear people. It looks like, what a blessing. If you come to your Rebbe, give me a blessing. I bless you that you fear Hashem like you fear the policeman who's looking who to give tickets when you don't have a mask. My Rebbe lost his mind. He's very old. What is he giving me? It's a curse, it's not a blessing. Rebbe, give me a blessing. Tell me, be healthy, be Talmid Chacham, have great children, find great shidduch, live long life, be rich, something, no? I bless you. See that policeman over there who looks to give tickets? Are you afraid of him? No, excuse me, sir. Give me one more chance that you should fear Hashem like you fear him. One time when a police pull you over in the middle of the night with all the lights, they come with the hands on the gun. That's when your heartbeat will go from 50 to 250. And your hands will begin to shake, and your blood circulation will somehow not circulate. That's when you will remember the blessing of Rabbi Yochanan. You should fear God like you fear people. One Arab gets on a bus in Israel, in the days that they used to blow up buses. What would happen? Half of the Israeli gets off in the first stop. Why? Everybody was shaking, especially if it was August and he wore a coat. That means he has bombs underneath. You have to hide it. An Arab gets on a bus in August with a Meil Dubon, puffy coat. People get out of the attack. People text, honey, I want you to know I loved you all my life. Why? I have 30 seconds. חילונים, שמע ישראל, מה המקום שלי, ביקר חסיד? שמע ישראל, השם, אחמד גלון, לבס, סיני, if you have bags, oh, you know what paranoia they had in those days? That's how it was, no exaggeration. People who come, if they see, hey, you, what are you doing here? Imagine he begins to walk like this. Everybody screamed, just like now with the corona. Put your mask! You Democrat, right? Now one Republican will scream to you, put your mask! Everyone will scream, put your mask, Democrat. Bernie Sanders or Sleepy Joe? Make a survey, tell me if I'm right or wrong. After he screamed that you put your mask, tell him you're right, sir, here, I put my mask. Can I ask you one favor, I'm curious. Who did you vote in the last election for? If one will tell you, Trump, come to me, I'll give you $100. How is that? Fair deal or no? But for everyone who will tell you Sleepy Joe, you give me $10. You're taking the deal or no? How do I know? Because I already know how the wicked people are. They're wicked in everything. In everything. Lefty. Why lefty have to be pro-gay? You have lefty opinions when it comes to politics. You're communist. But why are you pro-gay? It's two different things. Somehow they're all pro-gay. If you're a socialist communist, why are you pro-abortion? Why you want to murder babies? What does it have to do one thing with the other? You want to take from the rich and give to the poor? Fine. But why are you pro-abortion? Because once you're wicked, Hashem puts you in the hand of the Satan and he occupies every inch of you. Very interesting. It's unbelievable. You can see how the world is dividing now to two sides and the distance between them is growing by the minute. And that's exactly a prophecy in the Gemara 2,000 years ago.
Social distance.
Social distancing, exactly.
I'm a little bit confused about the Zionists, though, because
only a little bit.
No, but I need to tell you why. I grew up hearing that Golda, for example, Golda and the Ben Gurion were really heroes, and people really look up
sure.
to them.
Half and, of the Jews in the world grew up thinking they are heroes.
So why is it then that? Because I really recognize that what you said about the kibbutz is correct, and because I had to check myself. But I grew up really believing that the generation of Ben Gurion and Golda and the Zionists did the greatest thing in 2,000 years. I mean, so.
Why did they do great? Why did they teach you that they do great?
Created the opportunity for Jews to go home.
Okay. First of all, that's right there a lie. Now, next time when someone comes and tell you Ben Gurion and Golda shaped Israel and made Israel into a state that we can go home, tell them enough with these lies. Who made Israel a state? Hasidim Jews from Europe in 1880. The Aliyah Rishona, the first immigration to Israel, 1880, 140 years ago. That's 70 years before Israel became a state. 70 years before. Okay? In 1880, there was a bunch of, you can call it crazy, you can call it optimistic, you can call it believers, call it whatever you want. Bunch of Ashkenazim from Europe. I'll tell you their names, you can Google it. Yoel Moshe Salomon, Zerach Baranet. Just put those two names and you're gonna see a group of religious, all of them black hats, beards, and peot. Black and white, like Hasidim dress. You see their pictures on Google. They came to Israel.
Vilna Gaon,
yes, it's 200 years ago, but they did not form cities. They came, they had a little place and they lived there. I'm talking about those who actually bought all the swamps and hired the Arabs to plant eucalyptus trees and dried all the swamps and kicked away the malaria. People were dying there. Nobody wanted to live in Israel. Israel was all swamps and malaria. And the Arabs that were there, they owned some land, but the land had no value. This bottle of water was more valuable than an acre of land in Tel Aviv. See this $2 bottle? If you would ask a person, what would you like? 1 acre in the heart of Tel Aviv with swamps and malaria and people are dying every day? Or a clean bottle of water, he will grab the bottle of water. The property today worth hundreds of millions of dollars there. Each acre in Tel Aviv is hundreds of millions of dollars. But in 1880, it was a death sentence. So these Ashkenazim religious, very ultra-religious, they came to Israel, they started to buy property, and they hired the Arabs, they gave them some money. The Arabs planted trees, and the trees drank all the water and dried all the land. After they dried the land, these Ashkenazim from Europe, they started to build cities. Petach Tikva, Rishon LeZion, Rosh Pina. They made 32 cities, 5 major ones, but 32 settlements. And that's the beginning of Israel. Later on, 1917, came the second wave of immigration. All the Russian and Polish wicked, communist, Zionist, nothing about them is Zionist. The word Zion, it comes from the Torah, Zion, from the words of the prophets. They were enemies of the Torah. They were all Mechalelei Shabbat, they were all Itrefot. One thing they did not do, they did not marry Goyim. But not for religious reasons, for political reasons. They felt they're superb. We should not marry any foreigners. It's assimilation. It will make us weak. Not because God said so. You see, if I won't marry a Goya, it's because God said so. Nothing to do with me thinking I'm better than her, or I'm superior, or anything like that. God say, you're not allowed to marry any other nation? That's it. Yes, sir. No question asked. They did not want to marry the Goyim for different reasons. When the son of Theodor Herzl, Hans, that he refused to circumcise him. Herzl lit in his house Christmas tree every year. Herzl, the beginning of the Zionist movement. Herzl sent his children to a church to learn Christianity. Herzl sent a letter to the Pope, give me some time, I will turn all the new generation to become Catholic. And there will not be any more anti-Semitism. We don't need to fight the Jews. We all have to turn them to become Catholic. Once I'm gonna do it, you will not have any more problems with the Jewish issue. This is the hero, their hero. His picture is still in the Knesset until this moment, believe it or not. So all these wicked activists, they had one thing in mutual. They were all wicked, they all hated religion, and they all had a vision. What was their vision? To turn Israel to Paris, New York, and London. And they had Russian communist ideology. That's why they made Israel like the Russian days of Lenin. They made kibbutzim and moshavim. You have, if you want to be a worker, you have to join the union. They give you a red card like in Russia. You can never find a job if you're not a member of the Istadrut, just like in Russia. All the songs that they used to teach us in school are all Russian songs. They took the Russian words out and they made Hebrew words. All the songs, all the old-fashioned Israeli songs are all Russian and Polish. And when the Holocaust started, after they killed almost all the Jews in Europe, there were 1 million left. And Adolf Eichmann, the Nazis were losing the war, and they were about to, the Russians and the Americans are closing on them. He called an activist named Joel Brand. Joel Brand, you can read his book. I don't know if he has it in English, but he has his book in Hebrew. He was not religious, he was a Zionist activist working for them. They sent Joel Brand to meet Adolf Eichmann. Adolf Eichmann told him, I have 1 million Jews left. I'm willing to release them. Well, I'm willing to release them from the camp. I need 10,000 trucks full of blankets and medicine. I will give you a list of the medicines we need and blankets. You're gonna give me 10,000 trucks full of this equipment, and I'm gonna release the million Jews to any country you tell me. And Eichmann told him, I know that you don't trust me, so I will give you a deal that you cannot refuse. You only show me a letter of credit that you have the money. Before you release 1,000 trucks, I will release 100,000 Jews once they leave the border of Germany and to the country that you told me. After that, you transfer to me 1,000 trucks. I will release the second 100,000. So that means you have nothing to lose. I will first release them, and then you, and they had billions of dollars back then, 8 years ago. They were loaded, the Zionist organization worldwide. Until today, the Zionist Fund, they're one of the richest organizations in the world. So Yoel Brand was not an evil person. He wasn't like that. He came back to Israel and they started to give him the runaround. And they had a meeting, and then Ben Gurion, the hero that they told you is the hero, Ben Gurion, he got up, and this is what he said. This is in the book of Yoel Brand. Ben Gurion said, Ben Gurion said, they want to send to us 1 more million immigrant Jews full of lice to come over here that we should babysit them. I rather have one fat goat giving fresh milk in the farm than 1 million stinky immigrants coming here. And he let Eichmann kill 1 million Jews. Do you know how they did it? Yoel Brand told them, if you're not gonna release the money and let those Jews get out of the camps, I will publish to the whole world what you did. So they saw he's a leech, he doesn't let go. They told him, don't worry, we found someone that will give you the money. He's in Egypt. Go to Egypt. They sent him to Egypt. First he went to Turkey, then he came back, then sent him to Egypt. When he arrived to Egypt, they notified the Egyptian that a Jewish spy just is entering their land. They put him 60 days in prison, investigating him with tortures. And he said that his biggest torture was knowing that every day they murder 12,000 Jews every day while he's screaming and nobody hears. They kept him in jail until Eichmann and Hitler finished to kill all these last million Jews, and then they released him and he published his book, and now one person showed up to his funeral. They put him on a band. And half of the streets of Israel are named after these wicked, they are worse than the Nazis, because the Gemara say if you kill bodies, you're a murderer. But if you murder the soul, it's much worse because it's for eternity. Gadol HaMachti, Oyo Terminargo. They were both. They were murderers of souls and murderers of body. I'll give you one second example, and I'm sure after that you will not have any more questions. Ben Gurion was a prime minister. His right-hand man in the field was Yitzhak Rabin. Remember him? Yitzhak Rabin? There was a boat of Jewish immigrants coming after the Holocaust to Israel. Imagine there were months in the ocean. Remember those boats of 7 years ago? It's not what we have today. When they finally arrived to Israel, the British were in charge in Israel. Ben Gurion did not want to go into a political conflict with the British. So he wanted to send a message to Europe that every boat that is coming to Israel, the British will shoot them and they will get killed. So don't dare to come here, because we don't want no Jews to come to Israel. We want to have it all for ourselves. We don't want no ones. So what happened? He sent Rabin with his soldiers. And the mission was to shoot at them. And the name of the boat was Altalena. Famous, everybody knows in Israel that story. In the old generation, everybody knew. Rabin, in his book, which I read it myself when I was a fool, 35 years ago, still read all these nonsense books. In his books, there is a part that I read myself, and he was the ambassador of Israel in Washington. And Rabin said, people are asking me if I regret killing 16 Jews on the boat Altalena. My answer to them, I have no regret whatsoever. I was a general in the field. The old man gave the order, and I was the executor. The old man was Ben Gurion. That was his nickname, Azaken. That's how they used to call him. Ben Gurion gave the order, and I was the general in the field, and I had to execute the order. They murdered 16 of these miserable Jews that came after months in the ocean. They shot them and killed them. You understand? And I think after that, if I remember correctly, up to now, it's a fact. From now on, don't hold me by the word. I think that after that, they turned that boat to Cyprus. They put them in some camps over there in Cyprus, in tents, for X amount of time. I don't know what was the end of them. But this is an example of who these people used to be. You understand? And now everywhere you go in Israel, Ben Gurion Street, Rabin Street, this street, you know, they took the center of Tel Aviv, the name of the circle was Kikar Malchei Israel, the circle of the kings of Israel, King Saul, King David, King Chizkiyahu, all the holy people of the Tanakh. They threw all the holy kings to the garbage and they renamed it Kikar Rabin. Chalel Shabbat, a drunk. They took a drunk person, Chalel Shabbat, murderer that shot a Jew to kill them, and they put him. But you know, Hashem is always giving people what they deserve, measure for measure exactly. What was the end of Rabin? One guy came and shot him. Until today, for 30 years almost, they ask him, do you regret what you did? No, I have no regret whatsoever. If I could, I would kill Peres also. Until today, no matter how much they try to break him, they promise him to go out in a jail to see the daylight, we'll give you television, we'll give you radio, we'll give you all kinds of... No. You say that you regret. I don't regret. Rabbi say, you don't regret you killed 16 survivors after what they've been through, you shot them and killed them? I don't regret. Hashem said that someone will shoot you and he will scream, I don't regret. That's what life is all about. Nida keneged nida. Remember those words. Whatever, how do you say it in English? What goes around comes around. That's exactly what's happening. But sometimes it takes years to realize. Sometimes by the time we get the punishment, we have no clue what we're being punished for. We already forgot. It was 20 years ago. Someone that really try, Hashem will help him to see the connection. Last thing for today, we got the point that if you're righteous today, there's no guarantee you'll be righteous tomorrow. If Hashem is with you today and everything is booming, be on alert. Tomorrow everything can turn around. I'm sure a lot of hotels owners did not dream in last February what's coming for them. They are closed already for 10 months. Some of them have hundreds of hotels. Imagine the owner of Hilton. Thousands of hotels all over the world, most of them are closed for 10 months. Imagine the damage. Imagine how many billions or tens of billions of dollars they already lost. States, countries will be bankrupt by the end of all this. The dollar crashed from 4 shekel to 3.24. 20% reduction in few months in the value of American money. Do you know what it means? Tell you what it means. It means that when we went to Israel, we took some dollars, our money had power to buy things. Now when you come to Israel, first of all, nobody wants dollars. Can't pay with dollars. It's garbage dollars. Second, when you go to the exchange, you're going to get 3.2. They take a little commission. So for every dollar, you get 3.2 shekel instead of 4. If you bring $100,000, you just lost $20,000 in 3 months in the value of your money. If you bought $1 million, you lost $200,000. All these millionaire billionaires that you have around here, they want to make aliyah to Israel and they have $100 million cash. They just lost $20 million just from the value of the currency. Why American dollar is crashing? Because they're printing non-stop dollars here. Non-stop to give out money. Why they print so many hundreds of billions of dollars to give out to people? Because if you're not going to give people money, they're going to start making riots like you saw. And you're not going to be able to walk out of the house. And those politicians will not be able to walk in the street because people will shoot them. Because when people are hungry, there's going to be an anarchy. I said last Monday that from now on, every minute, it's going to be robberies. Every minute. Here, there was a guy here before. I don't think he's here. He left. He's here? He left? His grandmother was robbed today for $2,000. He robbed her today, an old woman. And there was a camera that was in a business there that actually saw. They covered themselves with their hat, everything. $2,000 from an old woman. They come with a gun, stick it to the thing, with a gun, give me what you have, don't make a beep, they take everything, take off your watch, take off your phone, give them everything cash. That's why I say to people, leave some cash in your pocket. Not a lot, $30, $40, and one credit card. Don't put any. Why? Because if they can steal everything in the wallet, by the time you're gonna remember which credit card you have and where is their telephone number, they're gonna already make $100,000 debt. So have one card and remember the 800 number. That when you get robbed, you'll know when to run and dial an 800 number and call the credit card company and cancel it right away. And why I say to leave some cash? Because if you won't have any cash, from anger, they're gonna shoot you or stab. So you give them something at least. Better you leave a lot of singles and fives. It looks a lot. Staff of cash, you give it to him. Don't forget, they're also nervous. They wanna run. You give it to them, and that's it. And that's what it is, Rabotai. Make sure you have a password on your phone, that even if they steal it, they don't take all your information from your phone. That sometimes can be worse than the cash. If they get into your bank accounts and everything over there. That's a new world now. And they imagine if the dollars will continue to fall, you know what it means? That when we would like to buy a house in Israel, it will cost us $4 million instead of $1 million. Four. If the dollar will continue to cut, it will be one for one. You have houses in Israel. Today, they're offering a house in Israel in Caesarea. Guess how much is the price? One Russian oligarch bought this, built this mansion palace. It came out on the market today. What's the price of that house?
2 million.
Huh?
2 million.
2 million?
258.
Did you drink something today?
600 million.
2 million?
258.
A bathroom in Tel Aviv already cost 2 million. Huh?
260 million shekel.
$270 million. Do you know here in New York a house that costs $270 million in America, in New York? I don't think in Great Neck you have a house that worth $270 million. I don't think in Dili you have any house like that. I don't think in Brooklyn you have $270 million a house. I don't think so. Maybe where the movie stars live in over there, what, in Malibu, maybe over there, I don't know. But here, maybe Beverly Hills, yes. Do you know what's the difference? Here in America, you want to buy a small apartment in Manhattan. They're asking for a few million dollars. After you buy it, you still have to pay $6,000 a month maintenance. When I lived in Manhattan, 1991, I was paying rent in a small apartment, two bedrooms, $1,300. There was the rent of the house, and the building had a swimming pool, a doorman, indoor park, a lot of fancy in Upper East Side. I lived with a friend, one room for me, one room for him, two single guys. How much? $1,300. Each one paid $650. The electric bill of the old apartment was $50. $50. That's it. A gallon of gas was 99 cents. Bagel with cream cheese, 90 cents. Bagel with butter, 75 cents. Coffee, big one, 60 cents. Coffee. That was life. You wanted to buy an apartment in Manhattan? Let me give you a heads up. A building, four floors, with 12 apartments on First Avenue, 92nd Street, was sold for $400,000. A building, 12 apartments. They knock the building down and build a huge building over there. This was Manhattan. And soon, it's going back to those days. Give it another year and that's what's gonna happen. We're going back to those days, that's it. Who's gonna, now the problem would be that you come to buy an apartment that right now is $5 million, in 1 year it's gonna be $2 million. If you wait another year or two, there will be so many foreclosures, maybe it will go down to under $1 million. You know, after September 11, in Battery Park, those fancy buildings, apartments that was 7 million dropped overnight to 2 million. I know an Israeli guy bought many apartments. He had a lot of cash. He waited 3-4 months and went back to 7 and more, with fancy penthouses. He was smart. He already knew panic. Everyone's panicking. What's going to happen? The crash was happening already. The Arabs won't come again to September, to Twin Towers. There's nothing left there. So that's the safest place now. But people in their mind, this area is scarce. Everyone, and now everyone, but now it's a whole different story. It's not 2008, and it's not September 11. Those were momentary crash. Now this country is finished. Look what's going on over here. Everything is finished. The 1 year people don't pay mortgages. Nobody pays rent. Everyone, I said, well, what rent? I don't pay rent. You own a restaurant. I don't pay rent for 10 months. I don't pay. You don't pay. You don't pay. There's nothing they can do. You go to court, it's 1 year waiting just to start your case. Why should people pay? All the big companies left Manhattan, Google, Microsoft, all the people, they don't need anymore to rent for $200,000 an office. What for? Everybody works from home. They discover a new world. You can be a computer expert, work from your home. I want results. I don't care where you work and how many hours. This is your mission. By Thursday, I want it. And you get paid, that's it. And they don't need you anymore. Why should they hire Americans? Why should they hire an high-tech from America and paying $200,000 a year with Maharaja from India will do the same thing for $20,000 a year, 10%. They save $180,000 on a guy. This Indian guy, he knows computer almost as good as this American expert. And you don't need to pay Social Security for him. You don't have, I want results. I want you to build for me this app. Guy from Ukraine, guy from Bombay, guy from all over the world. Same thing Israelis now. You know how many Israelis working now in American companies? You don't need any more Social Security. You don't need to be legal here. You work with remote control. All of us, I know a lot of Americans that made Aliyah, they work for American companies from Israel. For them, Corona was great. Because now it's the new world. They don't have to come anymore to America. Everything is done remotely. This is a whole new world. The question is, will it ever go back again? Or that's it, Hashem is finished this place. Because remember, every empire was an empire for X amount of time. Usually, if you check history, 200 and change. Here, 200 years and change. And America is already 200 years. That's it. Once the end comes, Iran used to be an empire in the time of the Shah. Russia was an empire. They're starving there, most people today. Germany was an empire. It's a regular country now. The Greeks used to be an empire. They bankrupt small, tiny country. Spain used to be a massive empire. They're bankrupt, they're begging people to come and take a Spanish passport that should pay $5,000. You know, Spain and Portugal, they're both bankrupt. Philistines are not exist. England used to be occupied half of the world. Who is England? Terrible economy. So every one of these empires go one by one, nothing left from them. Same thing America. Now I want to remind you something, and we'll finish right here. Why empire rise and collapse? Every once in a while, new empire dominate the world. It all connects to the Jews. The Jews run the show in the world. Not because they want, because that's what God wants. And it's written in the Torah that the non-Jews admit that is the word of God. If they didn't admit, what's the proof? But in the Torah it says that in every nation you will be, you will always be the highlight of the place. Even though we're a very small community compared to America, 300 million Americans, 5 million Jews. No comparison. But the Jews are everywhere, politics. All the assistants of Trump, Jews. All the assistants of Sleepy Joe, Jews. Obama, Jews. Everyone around there, Reform Jew, conservative Jews, Chabadnik, this, convert. It's all somehow. Same thing was in Spain, Same thing was in many different countries. When the country hosts the Jews, and the Jews live in that country with freedom, God bless this place thanks to the Jews there. As soon as they torture them, or kill them, or throw them out of the country, the end of this empire shortly after comes. Let's go one by one. The Roman Empire, when they started with the Jews, that was their end. After the Jews, no more Roman Empire. The Greeks, same story. Babylonians disappeared. Persians, Achashverosh, disappeared. In Iran, modern days, the Iranian Shah was very good to the Jews. Iran was the fourth powerful country in the world in its time. After Russia, America, I think Germany, Iran, it's paradise. So wealthy, selling oil, controlling the market. Iran was an empire 30 years ago. They kicked all the Jews ran away when Khomeini came. They went back in time 1,000 years. Because nobody has what to eat there. The end of Iran came. Germany, they killed the Jews. They used to be a massive empire. They stayed a small country now, nothing special. And Spain, same thing. The Jews were in power. They did the Spanish Inquisition. Spain and Portugal, nothing is left from them. Russia, there were many hundreds of thousands of Jews there. Russia was a very powerful empire. No one was checking for them. The Jews left Russia. The USSR collapsed. Now the Jews gonna run away from America. Most of them assimilated, so they become goyim already, their children. So they have nothing to wear because they're not Jewish. But those who are still religious, they will all get up within a year or two or five. We'll all have to run away from here. Once we will leave this place, Hashem will bury America. That's what's gonna happen. Not because I'm some kind of a prophet. I'm not giving you any prophecies here. I'm just describing to you a divine formula. The chosen people, where they're going to live, and you'll be good to them and nice to them, I will bless you from the place. The Torah has a source for it. Paro had a minister, Potiphar. He was one of the most powerful people in the world, Potiphar. Paro is the king of the world. Egypt is the empire of the world, and Potiphar is one of the members of the government. Yosef, the tzaddik, 17 years old, is sold to Egypt and arrived to the house of Potiphar to become a servant. The next verse in the Torah, from the minute the Jew entered the house of this minister Goy, Hashem blessed the Goy in everything he touched. A verse in a divine book. So if you ask sources, that's your source. The Jew walked into the house, he became a super blessed minister. Why? Because Hashem wanted the goyim to see that they have incentive to be nice to the Jews. Unfortunately, they're not getting it. Some of them do get it. Most of them don't get it. So they take their anger on the Jews. They force them to leave. They force them to suffer, and either they kill them or they run away, and the goyim pay the price. The Gemara say, the goyim destroyed Bet HaMikdash, the temple, and they don't know what they destroyed. Because in Bet HaMikdash, the Jews would sacrifice on Sukkot 70 cows, each cow for another nation, and praying for the goyim. The Jews were praying for all the nations in the world to have peace, prosperity, success. The goyim came and destroyed the place that the blessing comes to them. Why? Ignorance, stupidity, whatever you want to call it. And there's hundreds of examples like this. Once Yitzchak came and he lived among Avimelech, right away they told him, oh, since you came here, you became greater than all of us. You see the blessing of Hashem in everywhere you go. But at least we know one thing. Somebody runs the show. So whenever we get upset and we get disappointed and Trump lost and Sleepy Joe took over and another anti-Semite is taking over and the Democratic Party becomes more Muslim and more anti-Semite and we all becoming upset, we forget for a minute that it's all a divine plan. Before Haman was hung on a tree with all his mates, Haman had more than 200 sons. But only 10 of them were hung. The 10 anti-Semite ones. The other sons were not hating Jews. Hitler, if he had 200 kids, not necessarily all of them are Nazis hating Jews. Some of them don't hate. Same thing by a son of the head of the Hamas is pro-Israel. You know, he gives speeches. How terrible is the Hamas and how they murder Jews and how he loved the Jews. He came out of the Hamas and he's pro-Jews. Haman prepared a tree, 50 Amot, 75 feet. That was the size of the tree. To hang Mordechai. Mordechai was the chief rabbi of the world. He was in the Sanhedrin. He was a prophet. He prepared it. In one moment before the king gave him the ring, you are the strongest person in the world. And you have my ring and my stamp to kill all Jews in 127 countries. And he already sent letters. And he already set up a date. Everything was ready for the date that the Goyim will do riots and kill all Jews and take away all the property. Imagine how they were counting the minutes. All the anti-Semites in 127. Wow, it's soon Adar. Wow, another month. 29 days. This Jew is mine. No, he's mine. No, you take this Jew. Imagine. Because this Jew has a house and this one has a business. And the Haman wrote, everyone can do whatever they want to the Jews. Take away, kill them. No punishment. You have pardon from the government. So imagine how disappointed they were when there was another letter saying that the first decree is canceled. And what happened? The tree that he prepared for the Jews, they hung him over there, and the Jews killed 75,500 anti-Semite Nazis in Persia of those days. Imagine a day before how the Jews were depressed, everyone was fasting. It was Leila Seder. Passover night, instead of doing Leila Seder, the Jews sat in the center of Shushan wearing sacks, fasting for 3 days and reading Tehillim, crying to Hashem. That moment, it was a horrible moment in history. All the children, everybody else, everybody sits in town, everyone is depressed, in a few days we're going to die. All our property will be destroyed. Imagine how terrible it was. And a minute later, v'nafochu. Everything turned around 180 degrees. Not only that, they took over everywhere. And the Jews became the leaders again of the whole world. Same thing now. We cry for this, we cry for that. We are in the middle of the movie. In the middle of the movie, it looks like the good actor is about to die. His wife is about to die. She was kidnapped. Wow, they already say she's dead. All of a sudden, she's showing up. What? No, they didn't really kill me. They mean that. Oh, all of a sudden, I was upset for 45 minutes for nothing. Why? Because you thought. But when I go to Israel, I see my mother sits in the living room watching this Turkish, what do you call it? Soap opera, whatever you call it. And they are very sad. For whatever reason, these Turkish people, they like to depress you. So she sits like this. What happened? Ahmed and Fatma, such a nice couple. But look what happened. Fatma, they took her, they kidnapped her. I said, but why are you crying? My heart breaks. Why your heart breaks? They're such a nice couple. They had such good marriage. Why this evil person had to steal her and he gave her to her son and the son is a bad person? She actually thinks it's reality. This is us. We laugh. We are like this. It looks like, wow, this happened. And wow. And Hashem is standing in Shamayim laughing at us. You still did not get the point that you have to have some trust in me. That everything I ever did was for you. It's very difficult because it looks like, oh my gosh, we are in serious problem. But when the end comes, there is one verse in the end. What is it? Az imales chokpinu ulshonenu rina. When the salvation will come, as then our mouth will not stop laughing. And our tongue will not stop singing to Hashem from happiness. So we know the end. We just don't know when it will be. That's it. But we know for sure how it will be. It's a promise in the Tanakh. There will be moment that Hashem will wipe all the wicked people from the world, Jews and non-Jews. Only righteous people will survive. There will be a third temple. All the nations will live in peace and harmony. There will be no armies anymore. No one will be sick. Nobody dies anymore. No more babies born. No more incarnation. No more death. No more sicknesses. A wonderful world. And we will not stop singing and laughing from happiness. Right now, you win the lottery, 2 days later you cry. What happened, Moshe? Why you cry? Such a horrible son. My mother-in-law, my father-in-law. There's so many problems that even the lottery did not make you a happy person. There's so many other issues. There's no peace of mind. This and that and lawsuit and neighbor and that and the son and the daughter and the grandfather. So many problems. And cancer, and this, and that, and corona, and mask. Can't get married. You have to go to Dubai to get married. The Iranian plan to bomb the wedding. So much stress. But back in those days, none of these fears will exist. That's it. It will be obvious anymore. Remember, right now we can't be happy. Unless you're in a very high level. They show a video today in Israel, some breast level. Five police arresting him, putting handcuffs on him. I don't know for what. He doesn't have a mask. So they try to close the handcuffs on his hand, and he's dancing. And as a Tov Hashem, Hashem is so great. Thank you, Hashem. Everything you do, I appreciate it. And these five Israeli wicked, standing over there looking at him, they want to choke him to death. You know, like they're dying to kill him, but they can't. There's someone always filming. And he's dancing. I know it's all for my good. Thank you, I appreciate it. They're going crazy. They think they're going to break his spirit. Aziman es chok pin wa shonen o nebrina. Baruch Adonai l'olam. Amen v'amen. Bichanayim et kashay omen. רצה הקדוש ברוך הוא לזכות את ישראל